Let's start.
All right, guys, welcome back to another episode
15.
Got it right this time. The Intelligent Idea Talkers Podcast. I'm your host D.
This is Juice.
Your boy Jay.
Yeah. And we back. How's everything going? Hey, off the top, can I get a toast?
Yeah,
toast.
We were gloating pre-cast about how we've been doing it up in style with the
what is this?
With the wine. Hey, don't read the juice. We're drinking wine, people. Right?
Red wine. It's delicious.
You can tell by the color.
And it's a very delicious tasting wine.
Yes, it's almost sugary.
Yeah, it's very tasty. But yeah, welcome back, man. Thanks for joining us, man. It's been an interesting week, as always, dominated by Donald Trump.
But yeah, I think, he's been all over the headlines. If y'all ain't scared yet, I don't know what to tell you. You probably voted for him, honestly. And I don't know what
it's
he was
the Trump Idea Talkers Podcast coming at you.
I know, right?
I mean, jeez. But yep, I guess we're going to start out with an interesting trailer we saw the other day. Get Out.
D just blew the lid off the whole story, honestly, man. Like, just now.
It was a movie called Get Out. So that's an indie
film.
So
here's the premise. Here's the premise for Get Out from the trailer, if you don't know. A black guy is dating a white girl, and he's doing what everybody does when you've been dating a girl for a long time. You go and meet the family.
Getting serious.
Right, it's getting serious. So he goes, and he meets his white girlfriend's family out in rural, suburban area.
In the sticks.
Yeah, right. Somewhere out in the burbs.
Right. So, and then the madness starts happening, apparently. Something about hypnosis. We haven't seen the movie, you know. This is about the trailer. But the whole question initially was why? Why would you make a horror movie based on, I guess, I'm not going to say it's the most horrifying situation, but when you go, whenever a black guy go visit.
No, that'd be pretty horrifying.
Right, you're a black guy, you go visit your white girlfriend's family for the first time. You don't know what you're about to expect.
The countryside,
They could have came out there in hoods. That'd have been a lot shorter movie.
You're like one of three black people, and the other two black people are like zombified in that.
Yeah.
So it's like kind of scary, you know what I mean? I mean, even now in reality, you know, if you go into going to any place, a restaurant or something, you're the only black dude in there, you look around like...
You're already kind of nervous.
Or even if you're the only Asian guy in there, you look around like, I'm the only Asian. Even if you're the only white person, you look around like, damn, ain't no other white people. You know what I mean? So you feel everybody, man. It's hard to trust people nowadays.
But D just blew the lid off this whole thing, man.
What's the guy's name?
The producer?
Keegan-Michael Key is the tall, bald-headed dude.
Right, but this is directed by Jordan Peele from Key and Peele.
So, I watched all the comedy skits. Most of them on YouTube, though. They are funny.
So now I'm kind of really wanting to see this, just to be like, what?
It probably is stupid and funny. It probably is going to be funny.
It's going to be scary.
My original version of this movie, though, I thought it was actually serious, but I thought it was more satire.
Right, exactly. You know, like, it's going to make some kind of political statement. Like, maybe they're aliens and not really the girl's family, right? Or something. Like, oh, you was worried about nothing. Like,
or maybe this was like 50 years ago.
Like, maybe they killed a bunch of black people and the ghost of the black people is haunting the town
maybe
or something.
Maybe the white people were possessed by the ghosts of black slaves.
But it was so hokey and crazy when I looked
that
at
sounds
the,
like a good movie, though.
When I looked at the trailer, man, that's another reason we need a camera so we can reference it and people know what we're talking about. But anyways,
yeah.
It's so hokey when I looked at the trailer. I was like, this can't be serious. Like, in these racially tense times, you know, economically and politically.
In the news.
Exactly. Right.
You can't release a movie like
Black
this.
Black Lives Matter protesting.
Right. Black Lives Matter. How are you going to have a movie about this then? Like,
we're going to put white people on the spot. We're going to put black people on the spot.
When does it come out?
Do
you know?
Which,
when I saw. Release date, January 23.
When I saw that guy's name, the guy who was directing it.
Come on. It's February 24th. That was a Sundance release date. U.S. release date is February 24th.
When I saw that guy who was actually directing it, I was like, okay, this has to be a funny movie because it can't be serious.
But I don't think it's going to be funny. I think it's going to be ironically funny. Like, wow, really? It's going to be more along the lines of, you're just going to be like, are they really doing this?
You ever seen The 40-Year-Old Virgin?
Yeah.
You seen that? And that was a funny movie, right?
Funny
but when
movie,
I initially
yeah.
saw the trailer, I was like, is this serious or what? Because I couldn't tell, like, whether it was a... I mean,
I don't remember seeing the trailer for that.
But they didn't really hype it up like that. I think I saw the trailer on, like, YouTube or something, or saw it once.
This is going to be some Black Mirror type.
But when I saw it, it was funny. And I was like, you know, maybe sometimes you got to give movies a chance, man. Funny movies, you know. Get Out.
I'm sorry.
And then like, the name
I'm
of the movie is Get Out. So like, get he's out, in a town like, full of white people. As a black dude, they tell him Get Out. Like, you know, I was like,
this can't be real.
I don't know if you guys out there have seen the trailer yet. One of the most hit close to home. You know, when they pop a tire, and the white girl, the girlfriend, is driving, and a cop pulls him. You know, kind of comes up and is like, hey, you know, I need to see your license. Talking to the guy. And he was like, oh, but I wasn't driving. He goes, I didn't ask for your driver's license. I asked for your ID.
Right, you know? Like, putting him on the spot automatically, it's like, really? Racially profiling him. And then that's just the beginning of the movie. Then it leads into
them actually getting to the town.
It's like the worst fear of any person who's gone to visit his girl's family, right? Like, you go in there.
It's already nerve-wracking.
It's already nerve-wracking. And then even if she was black, out of hand.
Even if it wasn't white people. Yeah, you'd be nervous. I'm going to meet her entire family.
Like, yeah. And then it turns out they have possessed, like, or hypnotized people. And then they try to hypnotize you.
I think I saw a body part fall off some one of them dudes, man. Like, I think a finger or something fell off of me. I'm not serious on that. But, come on. They were zombified. They were like... What do you mean? You know what I mean? Like, I think
like
they told
when
him
reached
to get
out to dap the dude and he shook his or to shook pound his fist, the dude and he shook his fist.
I was like oh, this can't be real.
This can't be real.
He shook
man.
His pound.
Yeah.
It's like, how much more white can you get? Oh. Okay, well, I'm sorry. I'm not trying to blast anybody racially, but it's just funny.
It's funny. Like, that shit is funny.
I think even on that part where the cop asked for his ID, like, was the white girl changing the tire?
I think she was.
Like, I think the black dude was standing up like behind her. Like if they had like a quick cut.
Damn.
But I think she was the one down on her knee. I'm like, wait a minute.
Oh, come on.
I don't know. That's
so they're playing to every back it up. Stereotype.
Exactly.
You're
yeah.
twisting.
I'm surprised.
You blew the lid off the story, dude. Because
I'm surprised the cop didn't yell, "Hey, stop arresting! Stop resisting!
Yeah, resisting!
Stop resisting! I'm just standing here. Stop resisting!" I'm like, yeah,
batoned him upside the head or something. You know, pulled out a little
tire iron or the nightstick.
Was it the folding knife? Nightstick.
Dang, yo, like.
Called him boy or something. It looks funny though.
Jordan Peele.
Yeah, because you know I watched so many of their videos online, man, and I just recognized his name, but they didn't show a picture of him.
They didn't.
I was like, is it the same guy?
Like I remember, I always watch the trailer. Like as with all commercials, I only pay half attention to him, right? Mm-hmm. So if it's on, I'm like, oh, well, that looks weird, and then I'm moving on, trying to skip the video to watch my YouTube video, but. I never would have guessed that Jordan Peele was directing this joke.
Yeah,
and then D caught that joke. And then I'm like, because we were about to talk about this show. Like, seriously, like, why are they making this strange movie? Like, why are they going out of the way to make this kind of... Look, now that I know Jordan Peele is involved, this is a comedy, all right? Or if it's not a comedy...
At least a satire.
Satire.
That's exactly what I thought.
It's a satire and it's going to be like...
It might be.
Ridiculous.
Maybe it'll have like a serious premise, but it'll be like kind of satire-y with the humor.
Because I mean, you said yourself, like you were like, man, this looks hokey.
Just the thumbnail.
It's a little corny, right? Like this looks like try too hard.
Yeah, exactly.
Like if they made a real... Like if this was a real like production directed by, I don't know, Scorsese... Like you'd be like, well, that's like a weird. Why would you go this? Why would you decide to make this movie?
Scorsese.
Right.
That's high class right there, man. He would never
like,
do a movie like that.
Why would you do that? But then you. Yeah.
Speaking of Martin Scorsese, man, have you ever seen the movie Gangs in New York? I just caught it again the other day. That's my movie, man. I got it on DVD.
I was just talking about that.
That was just a cool movie, man. He directed that, man. That was
a good ass movie.
Damn, that was a great movie.
Man.
That was a great movie, man.
Dead Rabbits.
Yeah. That was a great movie. I mean, even Bill the Butcher. I mean, that's my guy. We're getting off topic of Get Out, but yeah. Bill the Butcher would be dude. If you haven't seen Gangs in New York, go see it.
So it dropped in February, right?
Yeah, February 24th.
Black History Month?
Damn it, there goes another one, man. So
I mean...
When you start putting it together, it looks
kind of
like... Yeah,
it's all coming together now. Like, I think we... I'm sorry, people. I think we just spoiled it for you. Like, we just put this whole thing together. We saw
like,
the riddle.
The 28th or something? I would have at least delayed it like a couple of days.
It's the 24th.
Yeah. I would have delayed it a couple of days, make it in March. So that way it wouldn't
be like... push it back. But no, this is too ironic. Like, I'm sorry. This is it.
Yeah, hey. That's irony. That's it, man. And I guess, everybody go see Get Out. I might check it out. Is it going to release nationally?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, U.S. Tell us what
you know. That movie has no chance. I mean, the way movies go nowadays, like, I heard something like when they spend money on a movie, the budget of a movie, the whole, you have to meet a quota. I'm not sure the exact name of it. When you make the movie, you have to make your money back times a certain other percent. Like, so you have to fold it over like a time and a half. Yeah, to be considered like a success in what you, the resources and money you put into it.
Definitely.
Yeah.
This movie has no chance. I don't know how much they spent on it.
Well,
but
here's the thing. I've seen
it's
a
not
going
to make like Marvel movie numbers.
I've seen more trailers for this movie than I've seen for John Wick 2, right? Like, I've seen a lot of trailers for this movie, and I've seen it a lot of different places. So I'm like, they're putting enough money into the production. I just feel like people are going to go into this joint thinking this is a serious, like, serious movie, and they're just going to be like, like, I think that's gonna make this famous. I think that's gonna make people want to be like, "Yo, you gotta go see this movie." This I'm not movie, gonna tell you what happened. You gotta go see it.
This movie's gonna be in the theater for like 2 or 3 weeks.
You think so?
It's gone.
Nah, you might be right, man.
It's gonna be on DVD. I can never call in a month and a half. They just push movies through, man. When they don't do any money, they just push them through. Boom, DVD. You know, it'll be on DVD in like 2 months. Some movies take forever. You know what I mean? How long did Batman vs Superman take to come out? I heard they had to do while we're on the subject of movies, I heard they had to do Wonder Woman reshoots. I'm not sure exactly why or whatnot, but they went back to reshoot certain scenes. Who knows, man? Who knows what DC's doing?
I'm gonna need DC to not let that keep leaking out, because that leaked out for Batman vs Superman, for Suicide Squad, and now for Wonder Woman. Like, y'all gotta hold on to that a little tighter, because.
Well, I like Suicide Squad, and Batman vs Superman wasn't as bad as I initially thought in the movie theater. I had so much hype around that movie that it just let me down. It was set up to fail, because how many years were we anticipating Batman vs Superman?
I mean, since before, what was that movie?
Especially our generation. I know what you're talking about, the Will Smith joint.
Yeah, the Will Smith joint came out. Like, we saw that joint in the back. It was like, man, that would be cool.
Even when we were kids, like, we saw images of Batman versus Superman, you know, but how long did it take to come out?
I Am Legend, that's what I'm talking about.
Technology and a movie to make it, but, you know. I like the direction DC goes. I just think they put it together too much. And sometimes on the trailers, they give away too much. Like, how much of Batman vs. Superman did we see before,
yeah,
you know, we like saw that. The movie? You know?
I like, yeah.
Even Suicide Squad.
Like, I would much rather be, like, have quick, fast, flashy trailers.
Surprise.
But don't show me anything. Like, and don't show me the best parts. Yeah. Don't even mention
We shouldn't
the
even
best
have
parts.
Known that Doomsday was going to be in BVS. I mean, we should have known that he was going to be there.
Yeah.
If he would have just popped up, even though, like, how much, even, they have a problem with Superman, because how much further can you go to Man of Steel? He already battled somebody who's just as powerful as him. And then in Batman vs. Superman, he's supposed to fight Doomsday. But we know Superman, we already seen him battle this guy and destroy a city in the process, you know? So, like, what else can you do with Superman? The next thing is, like, a planet. He had to, like, destroy a planet, right? Like, the moon? Like, he just, like, punch the Earth out of orbit or something. Like, that's it? I mean,
well, he could do the whole flying backwards and go back in time.
Superman versus Goku. That's it.
Oh, man.
They have
come
a video on
yeah.
YouTube. I think they have a video on YouTube. Yeah, it's like a fan-made animation thing. But
oh, like, I don't want to talk about that, all right, goddamn it, because I don't like the way those outcomes are. I like Goku.
What's Speaking of which, man, the Final Fantasy, the second one that came out. Yeah. I know I'm all over the place. We're supposed to be on Get Out, but, like, yeah, man. Just let me, like, borrow that.
Yeah, I got it.
I haven't seen it yet, but I seen some more clips on YouTube, and I was like, man, I got to check it out.
Yeah, it's cool. It's not as good. It's not as good as having children, but it's still good.
Having children was cool. So, yeah. Next topic, I guess. Next movie coming out to wrap us up on this movie topic, I guess, would be John Wick 2. I'm gonna check that out. Has the Intelligent Idea Talker's recommendation stamp of approval.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, and then after that, what?
Oh,
Logan?
So Logan.
People
Logan.
Anticipate
and
that.
Then what's after Logan?
See, like, movies like Get Out and all that, even, like, if you don't, like, if you're not a comic book kind of sci-fi movie, it just has no hype around it. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. As far, because we know Logan's coming. Now, we're anticipating.
I might
we anticipate Spider-Man. Yeah, we are nerds, though. Yeah.
It's like, that's what I'm thinking. Like, that might just be us.
We're anticipating Spider-Man.
Like,
more
I imagine
than,
somebody's
like,
out there anticipating, like, I don't know. What else? I don't even know what else.
That's what I'm saying. We don't like a movie like Splinter.
I know there's some.
You seen the movie
The Zookeeper's Wife or something. Yeah. Like, somebody's out there anticipating The Zookeeper's Wife. Like, oh, I can't wait for this movie.
Who are these people?
To come out about The Zookeeper's Wife who's harboring Jews during the Nazi era. But, you know, I'm sure somebody's out there excited about that. Me, on the other hand, I was talking to Claudia the other day. I was like, look, if they don't have powers, I'm marginally interested. Like, I just barely care. Like if they don't have powers and nobody's fighting.
Or at least some kind of decent interesting, action.
But, you know? I'm not really caring.
Like an action, an intrigue, or like a lot of suspense. Like the Jason Bourne movies, right? Yeah. Like they had a lot of action, but it wasn't too much. It was a lot of
like he was above intriguing. Average, yeah. Right? So you have a above average character that's in that jump whooping ass. Like,
and you just, yeah, it's just, you know, it needs to keep you, I need to escape when I watch a movie. And exactly. I need to totally absorb myself into the world. And you just do that better with comic book movies. I mean, that's our generation. We grew up with Batman and Superman.
That is really it.
Especially the cartoons on Saturdays.
Yeah, man.
We were, if you think X-Men? About it, we were probably one of the last.
The X-Men cartoons are still better than the movies that came out. Hell yeah. I'm sorry. Like, hell yeah. I'm saying that. The X-Men cartoons back in the day, son.
Well, it's probably still favorite kitty.
Yeah, that intro, like, I'm sorry. That's better than any of the Marvel X-Men movies they came out with.
You remember when
maybe X-Men not the first movies. X-Men. The first X-Men was like epic, right? Though, because that was like the first, like you didn't think they could do.
The
X-Men
one with Nightcrawler was better than that one, though.
It was
the second one.
Well, that's only because the effects were better.
Hold on. Back in the day, Pizza Hut used to have a partnership with Marvel, and they had X-Men like comic books that they would give out.
Oh yeah, remember those? Right. Yeah,
with your little pan pizza and stuff.
Look, I thought you were about to say they were like selling like X-Men pizzas or something. Like it was like an X, like a professor. You know what?
I get that. they cut it in the X.
The pizza sauce was in the X.
I get that.
No, actually, what you always do?
The pan pizzas were in X's.
You know what I'm saying?
Like you open a box, it's a little sound, little machine in there, just says din 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 din. That's the theme music for the X-Men animated.
They were like, give me that box back though, when you're done with it. Damn.
That was right though. But if you watch that cartoon now, it's still probably kind of hokey.
It is hokey, but it's still good though.
Nostalgic though.
Like, think about how cool Dragon Ball Z was. I'm bouncing all over, but like Dragon Ball Z, when you watch, if you watch it now, today, you'd be like, okay, come on, just fight. You know what I mean? Like, just get through all this.
We only watched the whole thing back then because we had to.
They always like started talking about something like in the middle of a fight. They would just stop and start talking about something that happened. You know, in the past, I could never beat you.
Get and then they do a whole flashback for episodes.
Yeah. Uh-huh. My favorite joke. Right? How many Dragon Ball Z characters does it take to change a light bulb?
How many?
It takes one, but three episodes.
Exactly. Dragon Ball Z was
three episodes. You like. The whole time they're
just, next time we'll screw it in.
But who didn't try to power up in the mirror before you took a shower? Come on, man. Come on, everybody did.
What? I never did that. I don't know what y'all talking about.
Oh man, yeah, everybody tried that.
Yeah, man.
So,
speaking on the topic of movies, though, I want to talk about this James Baldwin movie. There was a documentary that came out for Black History Month. And me and Claudine went to see it today, this morning, called The Matinee. It is the name of the documentary about James Baldwin is called I Am Not Your Negro. And I just have to say, if you have the opportunity to see it, because it's not showing everywhere, you should take a minute and go see that movie. Like, James Baldwin, he's such a... I've only been marginally, like, interested in James Baldwin. I've always studied Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King, you know, the big, big heavy hitters. But James Baldwin was an author, and he did a lot of good work for not only civil rights, but for black people in general, as far as how black people view the world and how he views the world as a black man, and putting them in books so people can relate. And so the way they did this movie, it was narrated by Samuel Jackson, and I just have to say, like, the production was beautiful. Like, the clips they used, it was a very poignant movie. There was a woman sitting next to us that was bawling her eyes out. She was a white woman. I don't know if that had anything to do with that, but it happened.
Why did I come to this movie?
It makes me feel bad about myself.
On Rotten Tomatoes, they actually got a 95% approval rating.
Really?
And a 97 on Metacritic. So this is actually the second highest ranking movie of 2016.
I'm telling you, the production of this movie was good. Like, I mean, it was phenomenal. Like,
I want to see.
Like,
I'm impressed already.
Samuel Jackson's narration through this whole thing. He's reading letters from Baldwin to, I think, his editor. but about like the things he's experienced and the things he's planning to write about and things, and just the narration going through it. It's such an emotional, like, vivid narration. It's so good. Mm-hmm. Like,
that's pretty cool. Says this on IMDb, is Oscar nominated. I don't know. The Oscars happened already for 2016? They couldn't have, right? One of the Oscar shows. I don't call it the Oscars.
Well, this one, I mean, just on the Wikipedia, it says that it already won 11 international awards. Mm-hmm. So
32 overall nominations.
Yeah, it's crazy.
That's pretty cool. I mean, this is like worth checking out. I'm definitely interested.
Yeah. Like, he talks about the misrepresentation of media. Like, he talks about that a lot. And mm-hmm. you know, it's one of the things I always cling to. Hell, like, yeah. Media, the way media represents Black people and Native people and minorities mm-hmm. it's always been a very calculated lie, mm-hmm. right? And he, in that era, like, back then, he touches on that very clearly. Mm-hmm. Like, he goes and he talks about this point where African Americans, or where he was growing up, and during that era, like, Westerns were the thing. So he's talking about how when you're watching these Westerns, these Indians being killed, and you're a young Black kid, and you're rooting for these white cowboys, they're killing these Native Americans because, you know, they're the Native Americans are the bad guy. And then you realize, like, as he's growing up, he's saying, I grew up and I realized, like, that wasn't, like, I wasn't the white guy shooting these Indians. I wasn't the cowboy. Like, I was, damn. I was the Indians. Like, that was me. Like, they're closer to me than I am to the cowboy, you know? And I thought that was a very poignant statement because I think I definitely had that realization when I was going. You're watching TV.
How many times we play cowboys and Indians when we're young?
Right, you know? Mm-hmm. And you grow up and you're like, wow, it turns out, like, the heroes on TV, these heroes on TV, they're not at all like me. Like, they don't live the thing, they haven't seen the things I've seen, they haven't dealt with the things I've dealt with as a colored person, as a person of color, you know? And it turns out that it's very likely I'm more in tune with the villains in these shows mm-hmm. than the hero.
That's deep. Right?
And it's all a very deep psychological narrative that's being spun, man. Like, it's almost like a political propaganda, or, you know, like, even back in, like, World War II, when they, like, the soldiers are sitting there fighting. It's such, like, a horrific experience, right? But you have this, you know, this, you must fight for us, or whatever they would play over the audio speakers. And, you know, when you hear something constantly and it's being absorbed through your brain and your eyeballs, it just becomes part of reality, right?
So, or even the posters where they would demonize the other side.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Going back to media representation. Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy, man. Yeah. It's like it's a propaganda spin. I was listening to Dr. Boyce Watkins, man. He says something like, you know, even back during the Great Depression, his grandmother used to tell him, you know, the country fell into a deep depression and people didn't have jobs and they're standing on soup lines, and they were looking around, like, the Black community, that, you know, we didn't even realize there was a depression, or, you know, anybody who was already impoverished up to that point. Yeah, exactly. Like, now that the mass of people are, you know, and, you know,
in the strength and dire straits.
Exactly. So, and yeah, it was a poignant statement.
There was another point in the movie that, so, you talked a lot about Malcolm X and you know, the not the feud between them, but the difference between them. And they had one clip where Malcolm X was calling Martin Luther King coon mm-hmm. because he was, like, talking about peace and you have to fight, you know. But still, there was this one clip that was kind of really powerful to me. Like, I've watched Malcolm X clips. I've listened to him speak, you know, everything I could find on the internet. But one thing I never really encountered was, like, seeing him after the assassination. Mm-hmm. And in the video, they had, like, clips of him when he was, like, just laying there, like, dead. Like, no life in his face. Like the only time I've ever really observed Malcolm X was when he was alive. And you forget, like, of course, it's in the movies, it's in the books. Like, he was assassinated, but to me, it was just such a powerful, like, point that mm-hmm. somebody like him, you know, was gunned down, was shot.
Yeah, it's different, man.
You saw the people online viewing his body afterwards. You saw him laying there. And it was sad, man. It was like, wow, like, it was such a powerful point to me.
You know, not to get morbid with it, but it's like even when you've been to a funeral, right? And like, and you can hear like, say, you know, not to get too morbid, you know, somebody, a family member, somebody died, and you hear it, and you're sad, and you know, you might cry. But when it really, when you go to the funeral itself, and you see the body actually laying there in front of you, you know, people start crying all over again. They fall into that depression. That is crazy looking, man. Looking at a picture of Malcolm X. Dead.
You can find it online now, but I never even thought to look for it. But
it's crazy when you have the visual of that person laying there. I mean, you can hear about, we hear about the war nowadays in Iraq and Afghanistan, how we're fighting in Yemen, and you know, you hear about it on the news, and you say, okay, well, it's, you know, they're fighting over there. But when you see the pictures of the cities bombed and dead,
you see the
kids
people
and,
laying there. You know, see the debris. You see the burned bodies. It becomes, it takes on a whole new realism. And that was something. Well, that was the whole thing with the Vietnam War, right? Like they were, like people were seeing soldiers being shot. They were seeing their people being killed. They were seeing like amputated people, people with amputated limbs. And people on stretchers running, trying to, getting shot at. Like, people were seeing this on the news, you know? Mm. That's when our news was, like, wild.
Because right? You probably had so many different news stations.
So now.
And then they just kind of absorbed into each other. All the companies absorbed. Now, CBS owns MSNBC, you know? There's other, you know, it's umbrella companies.
But when you see that stuff, like, so, it's such a, it takes on a whole nother layer, a whole nother level of meaning. And people in that era, in the Vietnam era, they were like, no. Like, we can't, no, bring them back. Like, this war is not worth it. This war is not worth it. We are sick of this war. Like, that was one of the big tides, one of the big pivotal moments in that point where people were like, we don't want to fight this war anymore. We don't want to be enlisted for this war anymore. We don't want our kids going over here anymore. There's nothing to be gained. We don't want any more to do with this because they were seeing the war. And
even before we even went there, it was such a, such a controversial war.
It was controversial.
You know, people were picketing. They were like, "Don't go in." You know, we should, you know, spread peace, not like bombs and bullets. Like to the point where, like, when the veterans came back, they were booed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
like that. Can you imagine what it's like to be like a Vietnam veteran? Like, you know, you were kind of put there trying to defend your country and stuff, and
they
then come
enlisted.
Back.
They had to go. A lot of them didn't.
No,
have
exactly.
A lot of
they
choice.
Had to go, but to come back from war. And then have your own countrymen boo you. Like, yeah, dude, that's hard. That's...
Yeah. Oh, it's beyond hard. I mean, I went over there and fought. I saw people killed. You know?
Yeah.
Imagine, like, the post-traumatic stress that they're going through on top of that, you know, top of being booed, you know. But, yeah, I mean, I'm definitely interested in this movie, man.
Yeah,
documentary.
It's good, man. Yeah, if you get a chance, you just check it out. Like, it's not in every theater, and honestly, it's only been showing for a week, so try to get out there and check it out if you can.
Man, I had a point that I wanted to make, and I totally forgot it. But, yeah, I'm definitely interested, man. And
let me say, again, the production. Like, look, it was beautifully shot.
Yeah, definitely, man. I definitely got to check that out. But, yeah, I mean, it...
I've seen a lot of documentaries, and this was one of the best shot ones.
I want to see it. Like, I keep looking at the little thumbnail here for the poster, you know what I mean? I'm like, that would be a cool background, or even
T-shirt.
Yeah,
something.
Yeah. No, I'm trying to
say. That'd be good.
T-shirt.
That'd be interesting. That'd be interesting.
Yeah.
You want to jump into this article about the immigration? Donald Trump definitely dominating the news nowadays, and, you know... We have no choice but to talk about him here on the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast, which is why I suggested the other day that we change it to the Donald Trump and Idea Talkers podcast, but I was shot down.
He's given us so much
by
material.
My compadres.
Trump's Ideas Talkers podcast.
Exactly. You know, Donald Trump, IRS.
These are Bannon's ideas.
It's crazy, man. A lot of this stuff, I was telling these guys pre-cast, like, they've managed to turn the presidency of the United States really into The Apprentice, into the... It's almost like a sitcom now, you know?
I feel like we're just going to be commercials at any point.
It's
I
like mean, a diversion.
When you're talking, a commercial
next on Donald
pop up.
Trump.
You know what I'm saying? Like, every day you wake up, and some new shit. Like next
why
time.
Don't we see commercials of Donald Trump's press conferences and like, his, you know... That should be a commercial, like a commercial for a show, like Full House or something.
Hey, it's
it should
still
be a commercial.
Early.
Like,
still early, dude.
Check
maybe,
out Donald Trump tonight at 7:30.
Patches on his jacket.
Yep.
Exxon, you know, BP.
Man, it's all money. To fight amongst capitalists, as put by a certain economist I listen to on YouTube. but I won't mention his name here on the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast. I'm over my Richard Wolf name limit as right
now. Okay, so with the whole Donald Trump thing, like, okay, what about the whole Muslim ban then? My biggest issue with this, other than, like, just how stupid the entire executive order was, is how are you actually going to check to see if they're Muslim? I mean, for real, like, if you detain somebody and say, you know, hey, are you Muslim? What if they say no? Like,
they'll look at them real hard and be like, all right, Muslim.
You know what? Exactly.
How you look them in the face and look them up and down? Like, hold on.
How you make that distinction?
You're a Muslim.
And again, like this, I was talking to Juice about this before we started. But you know, if you look at the Muslim community, you said it, like they're like the second biggest like religious group out there. On top of that, don't forget, like it's not just what you know Donald Trump is banning the Middle East, you know, countries, but it, you know, we also have like Asian Muslims, there's Black Muslims. If you look at like Indonesia or Singapore, like 90-something% of their population.
It's the second largest religion in the world.
So like how are you gonna ban them for real? Like
how can you possibly block these people from coming into the country of all the different ways that people get into the country, you know what I mean?
And that kind of just ties in with, like, you know, I can't remember the comedian that you showed us, the video clip, but, you know, a lot of undocumented immigrants come in through the country with work visas or with studying visas or what have you. They just overstay. Yeah. They don't necessarily cross the border, so building a wall isn't really going to stop them.
That's true, like,
It's like a diversion tactic. Like what'd you say the other day? And I said something like it was a diversionary tactic. Like they want to focus your attention over here on decoy. Something as silly as building a wall. You want to build a wall? Like what about that? I sent a video to the group the other day of this guy. He was just laughing at the bar. The fact that what about airplanes? You know what I mean? Right. How you gonna block people from coming in on airplanes? You know, I'm like,
big
yo,
old nets,
right?
Big nets.
I'm like, right. So what about the air, Donald? What about airplanes, bro?
When he used drones.
He was like, yo,
even if you managed to build this wall, how would you monitor this wall? How would you waste the manpower and resources to monitor the wall to make sure that nobody gets over it? How high is the wall gonna be? What are the specs of this wall that he's proposing? You know, so it's a diversionary tactic. It's so ridiculous that. That's why I said he's managed to turn this into a sitcom almost.
You know? Right. I don't know
like,
if
it
you guys
make sense, but it's happening.
I don't know if you guys watch Penn and Teller. Penn and Teller, they had a show called Bullshit back in the day, and basically
they did it, Showtime, all right.
And they actually had an episode about immigration and such, and they thought, you know what, let's build a wall because you know let's see you know how hard it would be to actually build. Let's build it with the specs that, you know, everyone's talking about.
Wait. So, yeah, the whole idea of a wall is not new.
Of course.
This isn't Trump's idea.
This is a while back.
Dude, you had a lot of people. They'd be like, oh, no.
Something like 5-6 years ago. But anyways, Penn and Teller, being the comedians that they are, they hired a bunch of undocumented workers because why not? They spent the entire day building this huge, elaborate wall. Huge. Maybe like 10 foot tall. And then it was made out of like metal sheets and stuff. They also had barbed wire on top. After they finished building, which they paid the undocumented workers, by the way, they asked the undocumented workers, we'll break you up into three teams. There's six of them, and we want to see how fast you guys can get through this. One, you have to go through one group. The other group has to go over the wall. The other group goes underneath the wall. And I think the longest time it took for each of the groups to take, I think it was something under a minute.
Really?
To do this. Exactly, under a minute.
Because
they spent the entire day building this wall.
It's just a wall.
But they went through it. They went over it and under it in under a minute.
Trump thinks he's building the Great Wall of China out there, Joe. Like, look, that's so ridiculous. It doesn't matter what you build.
That took years, too. That took centuries.
Look, you can always go over the wall, or you can go under the wall.
Logically, like, think about, first of all, we're even sitting here talking about him building this wall, and, like, you see reports of it on the news and everything like that. But, like I said, monitoring the wall, like, what are the specs of this wall? How big do you want it to be? Why not a fence? Wouldn't a fence save money? You know what I mean?
What about maintenance?
You can't even maintain your roads and bridges of the country's states.
Flint still ain't got clean.
Exactly.
How about we spend some of that money on like our education system?
Right. Or infrastructure. You know what I mean? Like build it up. Like make construction jobs. And you know, it's so much other things you could do than build this wall. You know? I mean,
is that really the best use of our time and money?
You know, wait, you know Trump's argument to that though? You know Trump's argument to that though? Nah, I want to build a wall. So that's it. He got nothing.
Because he's like, a capitalist and they're not used to being told no.
Nah, I want to build a wall.
He's not used to being told no. And he's going to have to learn that word as President of the United States. No, Donald.
No, we can't. Only Donald, hope, right?
Yeah, exactly. what I say?
Yeah, you're going to have to discipline Donald. But, you know, we're making fun of him, but he's the man in power. So we'll see what happens.
Back to this article.
He's the man that holds this position. Let's just put it like that. I don't know if he's the man in power.
No, Bannon's the man in power.
Country and government is too big. You can't have just one person in power. To think that Donald Trump alone controls the political world.
But what if he's able to consolidate all the power to where he more or less is by controlling everything?
That's part of this article, right?
I think it's too big.
So this article written by Jake Fuentes, the title of the article is "The Immigration Ban is a Head Fake and We're Falling for It."
Read it. It's really good.
It's a great article. It's a great article. Pretty much in the article, he goes over a couple of basic points. Pretty much it sounds like bargaining points to me. If you're an executive and you're bargaining for a contract or to get something done. So in this article, he talks about how the idea, what it seems like the plan Trump and his cabinet are trying to do is to consolidate the power in all the branches of government to where they will either bend for him or they just work for him. They do exactly what he says. And he's doing this by kind of testing his limits. And so in this article, he brings up this idea of like, look, so the first thing we need is some ridiculous, over-the-top executive order we can pass to see who would resist us. And then that would give us the leeway or first off, the information. And then from there, we can see if we can eliminate these people or if we can, you know, bring them in or we can make them work for us. The whole idea of this article is if Trump was to make a powerful move like this, will we be able to stop him? And I think that the way things are looking now is what he's done. I don't think so far, I don't think we have been able to. And I wonder, like, I'm worried mostly about can we, you know?
I mean, I think it's kind of smart in a very cynical way how he's able to push the boundaries and envelope and kind of just see, like, testing the water, like, how far can he really go? And it may be much further than he wants, but just to kind of see, you know, when people are going to have, you know, backlash, when people are going to protest and kind of, you know, shut him down. The next time he does that, he's going to take it down a notch.
Yeah.
But then, like, people aren't going to really boycott or whatever. What if he, like, reinstates something horrible, like, I don't know, slavery? Like, okay, it's not all Muslims. It's just black people. Or maybe maybe black Muslims. Or maybe something smaller than that. Maybe just indigenous people.
You're going to start with something heinous and then walk back. Right.
Because, hey, it's not as bad as all Muslims, but it's just...
Just some.
So I think that's what he's doing. He's trying to test the water, and that's scary.
Donald Trump is a capitalist, and he's applying the capitalist mindset set to the presidency of the United States. Like, up until this point, you've had people who've had backgrounds in capitalism, you know, around these centralized positions in government, the most powerful offices you can hold in government, but now we have a true capitalist there. Mm-hmm. So of course you're gonna test everything and see, you know, well, what can I do? What can I do? You're gonna apply that, and going back to your point about consolidation, that's what you do in business. You consolidate.
Yes, right. You consolidate power.
One headquarters instead of two headquarters, you have one, you know? You consolidate your power, makes it easier to control everything. And it's just a natural process that capitalism takes. And I mean, Donald Trump was a billionaire before he got into office. This is how he made his money. You know
one thing that gets me? It was like when people were like excited about Trump, they were like, they always say they want the government. Trump was, one of his arguments was like, he wanted to run the government like a business. And people were like, yay, he's going to run the government like a corporation, like a business. This is going to be great. I have to stress, like, look, if the government is run like a corporation, like a business, like the American people, we are not the employees of that company. We are the tools. We are the materials that they use. And most companies aren't worried about the materials. They're not worried about these things that they use. They're not worried about the nuts. They're not worried about the bolts. They're not worried about these silly little things. They're worried about is the return and the money they can get. I think a lot of people get it confused. They think like, oh, well, I mean, Trump's gonna look out for us. workers of this country, mm-hmm. man. No. Like, you have the wrong idea. Like, the people he's bringing in, his employees, are the people in the politics, and these congressmen that he can pay and he can push and bully to do what he wants. Those are his employees, and he'll look out for them.
That's what you do in business.
Those people who are loyal to him.
That's what you do in business. You bully the little man.
Right,
so
right.
So he run a country like a corporation, I mean.
But he's not worried about the materials. He's not worried about the sheet metal. He's not worried about the scraps. He's the not janitor. Worried about the... He's not worried about none of that stuff. He's worried about his return.
You know, one thing about being
can get
one thing about the janitor, if you go into a dirty restroom and it's dirty, you'll notice. You know what I mean? So we have the people power. You know what I mean? Like, that's one thing that we do have. When the money stops flowing, when we don't have the money to buy these services and to use, the less people are working, so they don't pay taxes. How does the government get money? If the point of a business is to make money, you run the government like a business. How does the government make money if people can't pay the taxes to pay the government? You know what I mean? Yeah. So it's like a trail you got to follow back. It's crazy, man. I mean, to think that he's going to run the government like a business. I mean, you know, it's already scary enough in these times when you hear about a government shutdown or something. I think that's coming up like this summer or something like that. They got to re-vote or something. I'm not sure. Is that... So I heard something about it on WTOP, but and like how many when you hear a report on the news that says Honda or whatever company had to lay off 5,000 workers because they and it brushes off your shoulder 5,000 Honda workers, yeah, that's like, 5,000 people that lost a job, you know. So if you run the government like a business
without a job,
you know what I mean? Like, what's next? Are government employees gonna start getting laid off in mass? Like you said, we're gonna automate everything, so you know you're gonna have. You know, even in the retail industry, you're not going to have people at kiosk anymore. You're going to have self-checkout lanes, so I don't have to pay this cashier $7.25 an hour.
I've seen it at this point at every, like, almost every store has self-checkout.
Oh, mm-hmm. Definitely. Like, $50 minimum wage? Nah, how about we just put a kiosk up? How about we put a machine?
Can. We'll spend this much money now and then just make it up in... All this money we don't have to pay the employees.
But it's so self-destructive.
All this insurance we don't have to take care of. All this benefits.
They never take a day off.
Right, they never take a day off. All these work hours we don't have to worry about.
Exactly, and paying electricity is a lot cheaper than paying bills, for their paychecks.
And so about this article, I know they had a list of key points about the playbook for Donald Trump's inner circle. And they were saying, they want to launch a series of executive orders. We've already been there. Craft a ban to be about 20% more extreme. This is one I wanted to talk about. We watch our opposition, number three in the list of, is this five, six key points? Number three, we watch our opposition pour out into the streets, protesting the extremes of our public measure, exactly as we intended. The protests dominate the news, but our base doesn't watch CNN anyway. The ACLU will file motions to oppose the most extreme parts of our measure. That's actually going to be useful, too. We don't actually care if we win. That's why we made it more extreme than it needed to be. You know, and it goes on.
Which is why this is so scary.
That's the phase we're in right now. You know,
right?
People
like
are pouring out into the streets in opposition.
People
like,
are pouring
in
opposition, and the ACLU is fighting it. Right? So
it's a capitalist mindset.
The lawyers are pushing back. People are trying to file lawsuits, and the idea is good. Like it's like Mr. Burns. You know, John like knitting his fingers. Like yeah.
it's like Denzel.
Who says I plan?
Hey, it's like Denzel said, man. This shit is chess. It ain't checkers.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Exactly.
He's making moves 2 or 3 moves ahead. Like you don't even see what's coming. Like we're reactionary. We're the people en masse. And you know what you see and hear in your news articles. And it's scary when you hear things like they can even manipulate your Facebook timeline. You notice that, right? Because you don't see posts from certain things. I'm like, I know I subscribe to more pages than this.
Yeah,
why am I
right.
not seeing?
That's exactly. true.
They can manipulate
it based on the algorithms, what you like and stuff. So if you like more conservative stuff, they can show you more conservative
come
stuff.
Come on, Jay. Don't say the word algorithm, because now you're taking it like on some corporate like craziness. It makes you scared, right? It's like, Juice, close that
Facebook
laptop.
Facebook is a corporate.
Hey, put some tape
over
that laptop.
Camera, exactly.
camera hold, exactly. man. All right? They could be watching you right now, man. It's scary, right?
I imagine winking at
you think about it, right? Like it's sci-fi, and it's kind of in the movies, but it's
they
possible.
No, it definitely it's true though, because if you look at Facebook, they've already had tons of lawsuits. They sell our information. They already said that. But the thing is, the reason why they're able to sell this is because it's already in the fine print. It's in the contract. When we sign up, we automatically give up our rights.
Didn't we talk about that one cast? Like
we did,
how we just you just agree, you're like, all right, whatever, just download. Could. You know what I mean? Like you just
whatever.
Do you agree to our app permissions and other
services?
Yes, whatever. Fuck
sure, whatever.
Yeah.
I just want to post puppy pictures. That's it. That's all I want.
Exactly.
Right? But they do it. They do it. Big Brother is real, man. Facebook definitely is. huge. Yeah. If you look at a lot of...
Guess what?
If you look at, like, say, Eric Snowden, if you look at a lot of these big people, they don't have Facebook for a reason. Because they don't want to have their information out there. They don't want to be data that's being sold around to third-party corporations and companies.
Even a place like Wikipedia, as much information as that has, I'm truly a fan of it can be manipulated.
Definitely.
Yeah. It's like, I just played a game on PS4 called Watch Dogs, right? I don't know if you guys ever played Watch Dogs. Yeah. But it's like about this like kind of technology and how they use, like you said, the algorithms and purchasing patterns of people and... You know, how they do this psychoanalysis and facial recognition with cameras and cell phones and microphones. And it's like, God damn it, this shit is true. No, like, I'm playing the game and I'm doing these things, but absolutely this is real life.
If you look at Facebook, if you look at Amazon, if you look at YouTube, if you look at Instagram, right? When you're talking into your speakerphone of your phone, right? Look at all the related articles that come up. Yeah. Look at all the ads. When you are shopping on Amazon, why does it say, we recommend this for you? Oh, how did you know my girl's birthday was coming up? Mm-hmm. Yo, how did you know she liked roses? How did you know that, you know, I like this and that car or whatever? They know this. They hear you. They listen to you.
Can I get more variety on these subjects? Like, damn, why do I keep seeing the same post from the same freaking page? You know what I mean? Like, you know, okay. Like, I know I've subscribed to, like, 800 more pages than this. Like,
yeah, you see the same, like, 5 pages. But this is the thing. Like, if the more, like you said, like, the more you click on or the more things you click on, they'll send you more stuff along those lines of what you like. And so, in a way, like,
don't Facebook, streamline my interest social like media. I want variety.
Yeah, right? Social media does... stream like your interest. And you know what, was the Washington Post, they created a website that gives you the two sides of, like, the conservative side and the liberal side, I guess.
Headlines and media and articles,
and they let you look at the other side, and you look up a topic. I have to look up
I know exactly what you're talking about.
You look up the topic, like, for instance, Hillary Clinton. And on the liberal side, you have the things we normally see about Hillary Clinton, right? Mm-hmm. And then on the conservative side, you'll see all these crazy things you've never seen before about Hillary Clinton. You know, probably something about she's a child molester.
I still like that photo you sent when she was doing, like, what was she doing, like the Dougie or something? She was dancing
I didn't see
the actual video of her doing it, but I saw a little picture. I wanted to see her doing it. Like,
let's see if I can find that.
Yo, number 4 point on this list, I was just sitting here reading it. While the nation's attention is on our extreme EO, slip a few more nuanced moves through. For example, reconfigure the National Security Council so that it's led by our inner circle. And it goes back to a point by, once again, another certain economist that I listen to, how Donald Trump has hired these members of his cabinet, I think about 4 or 5 key members that are former participants or maybe even still now shareholders or former employees of the Goldman Sachs bank. And what that says is that, yes, the people that help you get into power will be rewarded when you get there. I mean, if why are you putting...
Right.
Like, why would you put somebody as the head of any government, cabinet department who's not actually an expert in that field? You know what I mean?
Like, I feel like
why don't the top scientists have the positions in your cabinet?
Right, for dealing with the nuclear weapons. Exactly. And the Department of Energy. Or, like, why wouldn't you have somebody who knows something about physics?
Why would you not do what's naturally best for the people as a whole? Healthier, cleaner, safer, and that's better for you in the long run. It's because it's a corporate system where, you know, you can't upset the power structure, man. And, you know, Donald Trump is the true antithesis of that because he is a member of that class.
But, you know, that's not new. You know,
the one thing we have with Obama that's hope is that maybe Obama's not a member. He was also the first black president. But maybe he wasn't a member of that class, right? He came from humble beginnings, you know? And, I mean...
Kind of. I mean, he went to Harvard.
Donald Trump is, like, the same... Yeah, you're right about that. He did go to Harvard. But Donald Trump is, like, another level.
He was the closest
to a common person.
To a common person. Even though he went to Harvard, right? At least we hoped that he understood what people of color go through. We hoped that he understood what the common man's struggle was. So that's...
But Trump has no remote idea of
what the common... Can you blame him? He's never lived in that world.
No, he hasn't. Been a member of that. But that's the thing. Why do people? It's like the Kyoto to a alpha male figure. It's like, are they so okay with bending their head and saying, "Oh, well, this person who's never lived in my experience knows exactly what's best for me."
Mm-hmm.
Like, why do these people feel that way? You know, I can't grasp that, Joe. For some reason, it's just beyond my cognition. I can't grasp why they think that it's it's like rulership, like, because really that's what it is.
But you know,
like, rulership is the right way. People who bow to a monarchy, who bow to a lineage, somebody who's inherited power from their father,
mm-hmm.
and somehow because he inherited power from a father, you have to have some kind of strange belief system that makes you think that this person is genetically and inherently and on a magical level that's beyond anything that you can quantify, better than you.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. I mean, that's where we are. I mean, I don't even understand. Like, even your middle of the country, we're talking precast about, like, you know, in this area of the country that we live in, Eastern Seaboard, Northern Virginia, Alexandria, D.C., DMV area. We're kind of sheltered, especially on the coast of the country. Yeah. You know,
so bigger populations near big cities,
and people are moving away from the interior of the country.
More diverse, definitely,
because we built that up. You know, a lot of places like, you know, Denver, and there's warehouses, like, you know, trucking industry, manufacturing. You know, and when those jobs outsourced and left, right, to go to other places, I mean, you left that part of the country destitute. Mm-hmm. So now they're moving away from there. You know, they're moving to the coast where the jobs are.
Yeah.
And
so middle America is just looking plain Jane.
I bring that up to say, even your man who lives out in Detroit, who's, you know, maybe going through his employment issues, who voted for Donald Trump, just because he was a change from what he's been experiencing the last 25, 30 years, whatever. I mean, to think that he would bring change to you is a ridiculous notion, because he hasn't experienced what you've experienced either. He hasn't experienced what I've experienced as a man of color. You as a man of color, you as a man of color, or even the average white person in, you know, rural America.
He can't relate.
He can't relate.
Person's life. He's
come from wealth, and, you know, he's going to apply his capitalist
mentality. He's never not gotten what he wanted for Christmas, right? Like, that's something that's just beyond his comprehension. What do you mean I can't have a BMW?
What does he want for Christmas?
Exactly. I was just about to say, like, what does he get for Christmas? Like, what could you get Donald Trump?
Presidency.
I give him a bag of M&M's and be like, hey, eat these, motherfucking, right?
Somebody to give gold.
You like peanut? You like peanut or plain? Because I give you a bag of M&M's. Yeah. Damn, that sucks. Like, if you're Donald Trump's girlfriend, what do you buy him for Christmas? Like, do you say, you know, just you want to get him something?
Sex slaves.
Yeah. Donald Trump probably does have sex slaves.
He's got
sex. Must be awesome to be
Donald
Trump.
All up in the White House.
One thing I can say about Donald Trump. Well, I mean, to be Donald Trump. Let me rephrase. Not to be him, but to live his lifestyle, right? The things that money can buy and do for you.
Is it his,
we don't know about it, okay, because we have so never experienced
his,
that
is
level
it,
of
is it his
money.
Lifestyle? Or is it the lifestyle of the rich?
Dude,
or is it just to have privilege to be able to do that?
All of it. I mean,
all
because
he
has
that's
all
very
of that.
Different, because if you want to look at, say, a rich lifestyle, he's definitely as rich as it gets. But then if you look at, say, Bill Gates, he's pretty chill. Have you seen what he wears?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But his lifestyle is something that we can't experience, you know? I mean, even Warren Buffett, as much money as Warren Buffett gave back,
a nerd.
And, you know,
donated
charity,
something like 90 something.
He's still rich beyond our wildest dreams. You know what I mean? Like,
they say that Bill Gates, just talking about money, right? If you follow his trends of how much he grows each year,
mm-hmm.
right? Well, then before he dies, they say that he might be the first trillionaire. Trillionaire.
I'm all in. Just slide some of that over this way.
I watched a Warren Buffett documentary on HBO, man. I think it's Becoming Warren Buffett or Be Warren Buffett. And he was saying, like, you know, his wife always wanted to donate a large portion of their fortune to charities and, you know, to give back. And he was saying, like, so one thing I respected, because I can't relate to Warren Buffett as much as I can relate to Donald Trump. But one thing he said that I respected was, how much money do you need? You know what I mean? Like, what's the difference between $80 billion and $40 billion?
Nothing.
Right. Nothing. So why not give that $40 billion to the world? You know what I mean? Let people experience that money on a mass.
I was reading something.
Why do you need that money? You don't need it.
Speaking of money, I was reading something about Warren Buffett where, like, just to have...
You could buy a person
I guess
for
you
a
could call it a consultation, but just to have lunch with Warren Buffett, I think it's something like $15,000. Just to sit down with the man and eat with him.
He's paying. My ticket is $15,000, but he's
going to pay. You better get that lunch, yo. And I'm going to get, you know, a beer with it. I'm going to get dessert.
I'm running that bill up.
Appetizers.
I'm running the bill up.
Like, just keep bringing it. I'm just putting it in my bag. Just keep bringing it.
There's something we just can't relate to, man. Just Donald Trump, to think that he will represent the experience of the average white man. No, I'm not to cut you off. Yeah, but it's just, it's crazy. No, no. Why would you even vote for Donald Trump? It's the want of change and something different. You know, just because
to shake things up a little bit.
Exactly. Why not? Why not?
This whole
it's crazy, right?
Like, I know we go back to the election, but it was just such a shit show, man. I think it was just because of everything going on with the DNC, because of all like this the mudslinging. Yeah. I think that this is just my, you know, opinion. I think that the middle average American in like wherever was tired of politicians, was tired of all this, and they thought him, you know, Donald Trump, he might be like the new era, or he might be, you know, something of change. Mm-hmm. But they banked really hard on him, and this is not
the people that voted for that voted against Obama and voted for Trump. To think that Donald Trump has their interest at heart any more than Obama did is a ridiculous notion. You know what I mean? And it just is. You know, not to pit.
Like, you could kind of Donald Trump versus Obama, maybe, but Obama was kind of like he kind of probably tempered himself. I imagine, you know, in hindsight, but you probably imagine he probably tempered himself because he didn't want to piss off the white people. Mm-hmm. He didn't want to piss off the black people.
You have to goose step around this.
Yeah, he was goose stepping the whole time. Trump's like flipping tables and because throwing executive orders across the room.
Throwing out Muslims.
Because he can. Throwing out Muslims. He's a privileged white man.
You know, I actually read this quote somewhere online where it said, you know, you who didn't vote for Obama, you're a racist. I didn't vote for Trump because he's a racist. So people who didn't vote for Obama, they were racist because they didn't want a black guy to be president. But the same people who didn't want to vote for Trump, the people who, you know, didn't, you know, voted for Obama, they didn't want to vote for Trump because he is a racist. Because a lot of people were trying to throw that argument back. Yeah. They're like, oh, well, how come, you know, Obama was president, how come you're not voting for Trump? Well, no, it's because you guys didn't vote for him because you guys are racist. But we didn't vote for Trump because he's a racist. Now look at the Muslim ban.
I have a terrible thing to say, but I'm going to say it.
Yeah, say it.
If you don't know for sure which of your white friends did or didn't vote for Trump, they voted for Trump. Sorry.
One of my friends...
If you don't know which one of your white friends voted for... If they voted for Trump, Hillary, if they didn't say... If they're saying, I don't know... I'm not telling you who I voted for. They voted for Trump.
One of my friends, when I was growing up, right, we were just talking about, you know, racism and, you know, all this other stuff, right? And he was like, you know what? I've come up with this ingenious question to ask a bunch of my white friends to see if they're, like, subtly racist. And I was like, oh, I want to know. I want to know what this is. He goes, you know what? You ask your white friends, right? How many black people have come into your house? If they know a number, they're a racist. Because really, like, really, yo, why are you counting your friends? You know what I'm saying?
Come on, yeah.
Man, I don't know. I could probably count the number of white people that came into my house maybe on two hands. You know what I mean? Like, I really don't have a lot of white people that come into the crib. But I'm not a racist.
Well, maybe you could reward to say how many white friends you got.
Right? You know, it makes me, like, kind of goose-step around racism because, like, sometimes I wish I could go back and amend certain statements I say on the cast, you know, even back in, like, episode 2 or 3. But one thing I did say before was, like everybody's little racist to some extent. Not racist, but discriminatory. I mean, you know you're white, you know you're Asian, you know you're black. So when a white person walks into your house, you'll be like, damn, you're white. What are you doing here? You know what I mean? If I walk into a white person, I'll be like, damn, you black.
Sure, but I think it's all because of discomfort. Like, say,
I wasn't gonna start laughing until Juice started laughing.
What I was gonna say is, like, what I was gonna say is, black I, think it, I think it, I think it's all.
Oh, like, man. No, like, you look.
I was gonna say though, it all comes down to comfort. Though it all comes down to comfort. Yeah. It all comes down to, like, how much you think that other people are going to perceive you and how they're going to look at you. If you go to, say, a predominantly, white community, right, and you are a person of color, whether it be Latino, whether it be black or Asian, right, you walk in there, you're going to feel a little off. Even though they haven't said anything, right, you just feel off, right? It'd be the exact same if a white person came down to a black neighborhood, Southeast, right? They're going to feel a little off. So as a result, we try to click together. It's not saying that no one is completely zero racist. There are just
But that's not racist, right? Like, that's not at all the definition of what racist is.
A little prejudice, perhaps?
It's like, no, you have a bias, right? So it's cool. You can see somebody for their differences. Racism starts rearing its ugly head when you start making preconceived notions about this person, when you start treating this person differently, but when you start treating this person less or in a negative way, or even viewing them in a negative way. Because what about of
positive stereotypes, then? Positive stereotypes, would they be considered racist? Because, like, for example, if you have, like, if you have two kids, you know, and you have to pick one of them to play basketball, right? One of them is a black dude, and one of them is a white guy.
Well, if you haven't watched them play, then, yeah.
Right. But that's the thing, though. These are pre-assumptions that we make, though. Or, like, if you're sitting in class, and it's calculus, right? It's hard as shit, right? Yeah. You got an Asian dude in the corner, and you got, like, you know, like, who's Jose.
With your homework, ask. But,
I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that it is Super Bowl weekend, obviously, as the rest of the media is talking about. And, you know, definitely, man, if you're not watching Super Bowl tomorrow, I don't know where you must be living on the moon, because, like, the whole world, I mean, it's almost like a national holiday, right? But I bring that up to say that on the Patriots, I heard something this week that the Patriots have three white receivers. It's a dude named, like, Chris Hogan. Man, I forget the other two guys' name. I can't believe the name's running off. Three white receivers, right? But typically, that position in sports, if you look around the rest of the league, there are 31 teams, is dominated by people of color, black guys. You know what I mean? So it makes them stand out. And for that to be a point of emphasis as far as Super Bowl weekend, three white receivers, but it just, you know, it's like, goes back to the whole racial divide, the bias kind of thing.
Like, you would have never guessed them, but, you know, like I said, like, if you didn't see them play and you're like, oh, they ain't got no chance. So I'll go, where's Delonte? Like, you know what I'm saying? Crazy. Like, wait a minute. Like, that's racist. Yeah, yes. Even positive stereotypes can be racist. You know?
Yeah, there's just stereotypes everywhere. And that's what I said. I don't want to say they're racist, but they are. People do have a certain bias and discrimination towards other people. And then it's racism natural. Is a part of that.
That's
as well.
Natural, right? Mm-hmm. That's the most natural thing, right?
Yeah, man. It's crazy.
Looks but, like yo, back to the article. God, dude, we so far from this article. Like, I don't even know.
We get way off topic sometimes, man, but it's cool.
I guess just to kind of wrap up this article, all in all, I'm just going to jump to the last step in this seven-part breakdown. Point seven was that the dust settles. We have 100% of the executive order we originally wanted after they've overreached, went through the ACLU, seen the protesters, everything went as planned. Then they removed the people they didn't want, and they have consolidated their ability to be able to pass the things that they really do want. Then, you know, they've proven that they can ignore an entire branch of government, and now we've slipped in some subtle moves that will make the next test even easier. So that's all in all saying with the plan. I recommend you guys go read this article. It's called "The Immigration Ban is a Head Fake, and We're Falling for It." Then he goes on and talks about a couple of things to what we can do to kind of counteract this kind of, I don't know if we call it an attack, but whatever it is.
It is totally an
advance from the Trump cabinet.
It's a corporate mindset.
It's an interesting part. The first thing it says is, first, stop believing that protests alone do much good. So protests galvanize groups and display a strong opposition, but they are not sufficient.
Which I don't agree with. I mean, it does take political power as well, but protests, you can never discount the fact that you're bringing attention to a certain subject, you know what I mean? Agree. And that's what protests do. They bring attention and awareness to something.
I agree with them in that.
The problem is there's no
alone.
Political push behind it.
Right.
And that's the problem. But the attention to it is never a bad thing. Like, you can never say, you know, don't protest in honor of you know, women's rights and everything like that, because it brought attention to it. I mean,
definitely.
You know, and protest will as well.
But protest alone, though, if you're not out there calling your, you know, congressman, if you're not out there voting,
right,
then protest alone, though,
it's a moot point.
Right.
He goes out and he specifies what he's saying. He said, say protesters gain a mild symbolic concession. The fact that their anger has an outlet is useful to the other side. It says that when they feel like they've stood up for something, that they've done their part. Mm-hmm. And then that's the dangerous part of protesting. It's not just about going out and making your voice heard and being out there as a physical representation of the resistance. It's about not letting that be it. Like, don't just go and protest. Then after that, you have to go and you have to make, go vote. You have to be there for the next vote round of voting for the Congress. You have to be there for the next round of voting for Senate. You have to be there for the next, for your local officials. Be proactive, right? People love to go and, like you said, protest, and then that's it. They go home and they never deal with it anymore.
I think local officials are even more important to vote for. Yeah. Because they control what's going on in your neighborhoods, in your communities.
And find out about them. Like, find out who's paying these guys. Because you don't want those local officials who are being, you know, handed pockets of money.
I think a large problem with protests, especially in this area, would be the fact that we're all caught up in this, this economic system where we have to work to maintain our livelihood, you know? So, you know, yes, you can protest on Saturday, but like Jay said, you know, a little earlier, on Monday, you got to go back to work.
Yep.
You know what I mean? True. So,
it's only so much.
When do I find the time to go to this meeting for, you know, my council? I got to pick my kid up at 6 o'clock. You know what I mean?
What if you work weekends?
Yeah, I mean, you know, people en masse is what I mean. You know, I'm not trying to say that that nobody can, but it's crazy, man. It's part of the system that we're in.
Here's another part.
I would also say that, going back to the non-voter thing, man, my bad, Juice, but I think, speaking as a non-voter for this past election myself, which we've already kind of covered here on the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast, I personally just didn't think I should support either candidate with a vote, because I didn't like either candidate, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Whatever, but we don't have to go back to that position. But I think non-voting is a certain form of protest, just based off that kind of mindset, right? I mean, if maybe a large percent of the voters weren't compelled to vote, you know, they didn't feel that things were going to change for them, you know.
Here's a funny fact I heard.
And like you said, it can't affect you if you follow the trail back. President makes this executive order, follow the trail, a year or two later, it affects you, you know what I mean? Or a couple months down the road, you're affected. But maybe that is a form of protest.
I might be getting this wrong, but here's what I heard. I hope I'm not mistaken. But I heard that more people went to vote and wrote in a, like, Harambe or a nonsensical name.
Mm-hmm.
At the polls for the presidential election, then voted for either
these nuts. Oh, okay, yeah, okay.
Right,
these nuts.
Right, then voted for either candidate.
Wow.
So that's important. For more people wrote in nonsensical, whatever, and just turned in a empty ballot or a bullshit ballot, than voted for either candidate. That's what the fuck happened. That shit happened. And yeah. and definitely for Trump. If it was not for Hillary, then I might have got that part wrong. But the fact is that it was a large amount of people, a overwhelming majority of people who voted for Harambe over fucking Hillary or
that's why Trump. You know, going back to our discussion earlier, like I'll ask you guys a question. Would there ever be the start of another political party in this country? Do you think we'll ever go to that kind of radicalized measure? Because one thing we do have is the numbers in the in mass as, you know, the mass of people. So because a lot of these protests without the political movement behind it, you know, it's just kind of a shell. But you can't discount awareness and attention.
See, know? In order to get a new political party, though, that's scary, because like anytime when a new kid comes into class, right, you don't know who he is. You have no idea his background. Yeah. Right. When you have a new class, a new political party, though, like, that's scary. A lot of people might be supportive of that, but I think the overwhelming majority, I don't think they'll be ready for it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And they'll be too nervous to vote for it because, I mean, we've had a two-party system for decades.
Lifetimes.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Lifetimes.
So as a result, like, that's what we're
some
used
people
to.
Don't know how to react.
Change. I mean, we all embrace change. We all, you have to, right?
Change is really,
but the thing is, change inevitable. Is also scary, though.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So in order to have a new political system, political party come up, like, I'm all for it.
Do you think things will ever get to that point? And I think the power behind a new political party ran by, you know, you could say a millennial, it could be somebody young, you know, or that's the face of it, that really has the intentions of the people at heart.
It would have to be a socialist new party.
Would meet so much resistance. I mean, they would lock us stuff. Okay, because we don't. When you start monopolizing things like air and water, what chance do we have? You know what I mean? Fight. You have. It's going to come down to a battle.
Was it the Kennedy quote? They say when
they're not letting us live without supporting them, and we have purchasing power. That's one thing we do have, right? But you can't run a hospital without electricity. So if I don't pay this corporation to turn on this hospital for people to live, the hospital cuts off. You know what I mean? They close the hospital, you know? So it's like they're monopolizing the way that we live our lives.
People are going to have to fight. Like, I think the quote is, like, when you don't make a peaceful change or a peaceful revolution possible, you make violent revolution inevitable, right? So it's like they're going to have to either... There's no two ways about it, right? Like, we're not going to let them monopolize our water and our air. They're going to try, but I imagine the vast majority of people will fight when you can't eat and when you can't breathe.
Anybody saying, like, listener might say, you know, monopolize air, but Jay brought up a point earlier that, was it China?
In China, due to the just horrible smog and whatnot, there's companies who are canning air, canning O2 and whatever. Canada, Switzerland, I don't know.
They're shipping
it
to Canada.
And they're shipping it to China. And literally, it's like $4 to $7 a can. And you get a couple puffs of air. And this is a business. This is an actual business. I mean, you talk about monopolizing water. Like, it's almost funny, but bottled water.
Right, like it's not along the lines of where you don't buy this, you don't breathe, mm-hmm. but it's along the lines of if you want fresh air, if you don't want to breathe this funky ass air,
if you want fresh water, get bottled water.
You want fresh?
I apologize to all the Flint listeners out there. Okay, but honestly,
so many.
For everyone else. And North Dakota, or you know, the Dakotas, but everyone else, right? You're paying money for like your own water in your sink, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of have you had New York water before? Tap water?
No,
delicious. It's actually one of the most covered and most supervised places,
really?
Because it's such a huge city. It is actually really delicious. And if you look at say bottled water, how many of the bottled waters have found like arsenic inside, or they had fecal matter inside, like very, very small percentages of that within these giant companies. And if you look at, say, something like, I won't put Fuji on blast, but Fuji water, right? Like, it's not from Fuji or Fiji. My bad, Fiji. It's not from Fiji, right? Like, if you look at like the springs, if you have a natural spring, you call it Fiji, right? So then you can say it's from
spring.
No, exactly. That's what it is. Look it up. You can say, oh, this is from Fiji, but the Fiji actually could be in like New Jersey. Yeah. So if you look at deer park and stuff, right? Like a lot of these companies aren't necessarily that great.
There ain't no deers in these parks.
So you're paying water already. You're paying for the fluoride that's in your water. Like these are strengthening your teeth and all these things, right?
Yeah.
If you look at a lot of these bottled waters, they don't have fluoride. They don't have a lot of these things.
Either strengthening your teeth or calcifying your pineal gland. Just throwing that out there.
Hey, shout out to Joe Rogan. No, but seriously though, like they're all just because of marketing. People are preferring to drink bottled water over tap water. Like, honestly, in most big cities, there's real no difference, and probably tap water is probably better for you. So again, like this fighting for water, like there, it's been foretold that wars will be fought over water.
Yeah.
Later on. Yeah. And just by having bottled water, we're moving in that direction. Later on, by, you know, capitalizing, you know, cans of air. Like, that's going to be the next warfare, like, you know, agenda. And even the fact that we can't even collect rainwater in certain states. Like, really? That's a jailable offense or even a finable offense?
But I think it is, like...
Or even there's also in areas where, like, people have tried to turn off their electricity. And so they try to use solar powers or self-generate power. But then they were brought to court because they have to have, quote-unquote, electricity powered by a company.
But it's crazy because they're forcing you to pay for utility if you don't want it. It takes away, like, if that's not taking away a freedom...
Can you imagine people in Flint right now... And Flint still paying their water bill, but not being able to utilize their water.
That shit coming out brown in the fucking shower head.
Seriously. And like, people in Flint, call your legislation. Start boyboycotting. Start like, talk to your, fire your mayor.
Once again, there's power.
Fire your goddamn mayor.
There's power in mass, and like, you know, people don't. There's not a large amount of people in Flint, Michigan. That type of situation would, it would never happen around this area. Maybe we live in more of a privileged area.
You never know, though.
I don't think it would because there's too many people.
What about having that. The government shut down?
It's, thank you. Too many white people. You know what I mean? I mean, there's too many communities around here that would be affected if people didn't have clean drinking or water coming out of their taps. You know, I think if we did encounter a problem like that in this area, that we at least were in the DMV, they would have fixed that thing by now, man. I mean, come on. How long has Flint been dealing with this? How long have we heard about
over
this?
Over 1,000 days.
I mean, come on. Like,
over 1,000 days.
That's ridiculous. How do you let your infrastructure of your city, you know, water treatment, any water that comes from a water treatment plant, I'm already nervous about anyway. It's like, what kind of water are they treating it? You know what I mean? Like, it's...
They're recycling
the toilet like, water. Wait a minute, so they just take my shit out and just let it come back out the faucet? What is fecal matter?
Yo, they took your shit out. It was like...
Yeah, he shook it up.
Shook that shit up. Like, water shakers.
Yeah, it was like, you go. Let me strain this real quick. Are you good?
Strain the shit. Right,
take a shower again.
So, I'm all about, like, spreading awareness and talking about these things. I mean, this whole podcast is just spreading awareness about, you know, topics, but... The one thing that kind of makes me a little annoyed is how social media, we jump on these bandwagons.
We do, man.
Right? Kony 2012. We talk about, like, no pipeline, NA, you know, DPL, whatever, all that acronyms and stuff out there, right?
Yeah.
Like, we talk about all these things, but then that's just the flavor of the week. Like, Flint, we were all about that last year or 2 years ago. We were all about that all over news media, right? How many people still post about Flint?
It's rarely. You see it here and there, but this is like... And but nobody's doing shit about it. So that's the thing that's really frustrating, right? It's like, you want to do something. Like, I want to be able to go in there and smack the mayor in the face and be like, look, fix it. Like, there's no, it's easy to fix, right? It's going to cost you some money. If you're going to request money from the government, put the shit into this, right? Like, fix the problem. Your people are here dying, right? They're hurting. Fix the problem. You want to be able to go and do something, but we don't have the fucking power. We post about it, but there's always this.
Just put a little bit of money in, the return will be huge. It will be astronomical. Right. Save your community. Save your people. Give them some health care, right? The fact that they're not going to the hospital anymore, they're not paying all these massive bills, right? They're able to work. That puts tax monies back into the economy. That's going to boost your economy. By having them sick, by having them not able to work, by having them drain, like, welfare, by having them utilize, like, you know, all these charitable services... Like, that's hurting your economy. It's only going to make things worse. You're
supplying them a bottle of water still. It's like...
Don't forget, you're killing your citizens. Come on.
Get a fix.
It's so self-destructive, right?
At least start the project. At least assure us... At least assure the rest of the world that, look, we've looked at it, and we're going to take action to replace these pipes and get this fixed. They haven't even done that.
Ponying up the money is the problem. You know?
The money's there.
It's there, but it's just not being utilized for that.
Exactly.
It's not there. A trickle-down effect. It stays up here. It stays up at the very top of the triangle. It doesn't go down to the people.
No. That's the biggest load of shit.
It's crazy. Like, I referenced earlier a gentleman by the name of Jacques Fresco. Man, this dude's 100 years old, according to Wikipedia, wait, man. What? But I watched a documentary on
what is he eating or drinking?
Who, me?
Jacques
Fresco.
To get to 100, damn.
Yeah, I don't even know, man. He's drinking
that sweet red California wine, probably.
Damn it, Juice. You had to mention that?
Shut up.
I don't know what he's talking
about. I don't know what he's talking about, people. But, yeah, Jacques Fresco is a futurist, social engineer, structural engineer, architectural designer, industrial engineer, author, and a lecturer. He was the main interviewee for a three-part documentary. It's called The Venus Project. And it's just, they talk about a resource-based economy where you kind of transition from a monetary-based economy to resource-based, like where you use your air power and it's like structural social change where, like, why would you not use wind turbine energy? You know what I mean? Solar panels or... You know, ocean energy, you know how the ocean waves break and they can put turbines in the water that power places. And why would you not do these fundamentally healthier and better things for people. It's because of a capitalist HDTV. It's because of a capitalist economy. Yeah. And that's just, you know, it's
not. We have to look at who's being benefited.
It's not benefiting these people who control that, you know, who own these companies.
That's the thing. Like, if America put the energy into creating, being number one for solar and natural energy, we could do it. Like, there's so many ideas. Like, they're still coming up with new ideas.
But fossil fuels for immediate return, though.
It's immediate return. But if,
we're not thinking about the future. We're so destructive.
It's not we. It's them. Is those people at the top, those Exxon CEO people who are now it's fucking silly. Directors of...
I mean, why would you block an electric car? You know what I mean? Like, I heard that, you know, when the electric car, when they first came out, one of the first models that was street legal, like, a lot of the oil companies kind of stepped up and blocked legislation for that car to be sold in mass, you know?
Of course they did.
Why would you block an electric car?
Because they would lose money.
Yeah. I mean, it's healthier for the environment, you say. Our shareholders, stock prices are going to go down? No, block it.
Block it.
And then they lobby. They spend so much money.
It makes no sense.
They lobby.
It's ridiculous, man. Like, it makes no sense. Why would you block an electric car?
Because they don't give a fuck.
Why don't you
Why don't you
get in on the electric car business?
Right.
Get in on that business.
No, that's too logical. Because too logical. No, because if you, you know, think about like even like the reason why, you know, marijuana is illegal. Like William Randolph Hearst, for example, he owned the majority of the printing presses, right? And everything was being printed by the, you know, timber mills and all these things, right? They found out that cannabis, right? They found out that, you know, hemp was easier to produce. And also, it was much better for the environment. They can make papers out of it. But because he owned the monopoly...
He was like, I already got this going
on. He was like, I already had this going on. In order for me to switch to using, like, hemp, would cost me billions. So, F that. So, I'm just going to, you know, like, print out a bunch of garbage and make this legal.
Nowadays, it's like thousands.
Going back to Flint, it's like, why upset the apple cart? You know what I mean? Yeah. Coming up with that money right now for this particular problem, like, it would cost him billions right now. But in the long run, it would be better for him to use hemp paper as opposed to... You know, I'm using that press, but it's not
immediate feasible. Return. Exactly. You know what? I'm gonna let other generations deal with it.
Why would you not invest in renewable energy? Like, that's like, how do you argue against science? It's science, bitch. You know what I mean? Like you can't say that there's not global warming or, you know, there's not pollution due to cars and vehicles. All right. Like, it's science.
It's science, right, bitch.
Lick your finger and stick it in the air. You know
so,
I mean?
Real talk. Okay. Even though this is half joking, this is also half serious. D, right? So you say like renewable energy, all these things are great, and you're like, you know, you're the CEO of this giant conglomerate, you know, corporation, blah blah blah.
Do I have a 3-level penthouse? Right, like Donald Trump.
Oh, of course. Yeah, of course.
Okay, well
right?
then I'm not changing.
You're making massive money. Do you
but
change?
You're not gonna lose a 3-level.
No. Because you have all this money, though.
I think the power of money, man. We, coming from our backgrounds, we have an experience.
If Donald Trump right now gave you, like, 7 figures a year just to talk on the Intelligent Podcaster, Intelligent Ideas Podcaster.
We'd be one of the most well-funded podcasts.
But he said that you have to advocate for fossil fuel. You have to advocate for all these things. You know damn well you would do it, too.
Could I invest in renewable energy behind his back? Can I pull some like James Bond shit?
You know that his lawyers would. Because
I would say I like. I would say I like.
Would be airtight.
Hey, it's like Dave Chappelle said. I would say I like Coca Cola, but I drink Pepsi. You know what I mean? So like, I would do the same thing there. I'm thinking about that super hard.
Like shit.
Money, no, right.
If he gave me 6 figures.
Even 7 figures. You know, we all want to be loyal, right? And the thing is,
he gave me 4 figures.
Yeah, like, 4 figures. It's like, oh, hey, couple grand, no problem.
Like, hold on, right? Son,
but
like,
thing is, like,
yo,
we
want to
see these loyal things, right? And like, we want to fight the good fight, but when it comes to money, though, right? If you, especially when you go to the hood, you see people in Flint, Michigan, right? Like, definitely they want to change. They want renewable energy. They want drinking water, right? You take a couple of those families out. You put them in a, you relocate them to say, I don't know, Hawaii, right? And then you give them like 6 figures. They probably won't talk about Flint ever again.
No, don't forget about it. Because that's past.
Maybe. They might not. I don't know. But I'm assuming they probably won't. They're not going to go back and fight for it. Right. They're not going to go back and fight for it. So that's the same thing, though. Like, money corrupts.
So you're dealing with humans and human habit and human.
So I mean, life. I definitely want renewable energy. I definitely want to use solar panels, wind turbines. I think these are great things. But if I was in their situation and I was getting massive amounts of money, like that's kind of hard.
Maybe the idea is they're waiting mm-hmm. for the sales of solar panels. They're waiting for the sales of these electric cars. Maybe they're waiting for them to meet a
profitable.
Yeah, to meet a tipping point. And maybe once they reach that tipping point with the general population, mm-hmm. then they're like, oh, well, of course we're in this. We're going to catch on this.
Okay.
But isn't it more economically efficient?
And renewable energy, all these things. If you work for, say, Ford, or work for even Exxon, and fossil fuel is the foundation of your company, you're going to oppose that.
Wait, if I'm just working for them?
If you're working for them, or if you're like the CEO, if you're their PR person, right?
But will solar panels cut some off my electric bill? I'll throw some fucking solar panels off that son of a bitch real quick. Like,
we haven't came from money, so we underestimate what money can do, like what it can really do, you know, the lifestyle you can afford. So that definitely corrupts. Like, I mean, like, without a doubt.
None of us make close to six figures.
I mean,
but I think adding up, we don't even make.
I'm not even talking about just like
five figures.
You know, I'm talking about like true wealth. You know what I mean? Like where you have, I mean, you know, a lot of people now struggle to maintain a car. When you can collect cars, when you can go to automobile shows and do something just like in your leisure time. You know, we're gonna go
Jay
buy. We can't fathom that.
Jay Leno sell cars has a like, parking lot.
We can't.
He has a parking lot just because he collects cars. Jay Leno, right? We can't fathom that. Like we can't. Honestly, we can't fathom billion. We can't fathom 1 billion.
What does 1 billion even? What's the, like we said? Like, what's the difference between 80 billion and 40 billion?
It's just a lot of money.
Like
it's just
a lot. Even above like say 5 million, it's almost impossible for the
most
average
people
person
can't
to fathom.
Conceive. Yeah,
right. I mean, right. If you think if you get 5 million in your bank account tomorrow, you'd be set for the next 20 years. You know what I mean? Like
I'm gonna quit this podcast.
If you invest that money. If you invest that money wisely, you can make it work for your children and your grandchildren. You know what I mean? You
podcast.
Might not enter the realm of true wealth, you know, but you think that, right? But
once you get
what about when you have 5 billion?
You know? Once you get to 5 billion, though,
when you hear somebody,
are you
numbers,
marching? Are you protesting?
How can a man be worth $50 billion?
It's like $100 protest.
That's crazy.
A day.
Exactly. So like, I'm still gonna fight the good fight because I'm poor. Okay, because I'm still gonna be here for a while. I'm gonna retire anytime soon. But I'm just saying, though, like, I just wanted to kind of bring that up. There's no end to this conversation, this little talk. But it's just something to throw out there. Because, like, look, if you're making that kind of money, like, that's why it doesn't affect them.
Like, at what point do you decide, I've made enough? You never hit
humans
that
are
wall.
So greedy.
Yeah. It's like, you so never greedy. Hit that wall. You never be like, oh, this 6 million is, 6 billion is
so
enough.
So if you look
I'm
at Flint, Michigan, I guarantee someone is profiting. Someone is benefiting there. And the reason why nothing is changing is because that person, whoever that person is probably making a lot of
guarantee
money.
Guarantee that person doesn't
follow
live
the money, yo.
He probably
follow
doesn't
the
live
money.
In Flint.
Yeah,
you're right.
But they say follow the money. But that's why we have courts, right? Like, that's why, because that shit happens, we have a legal system, we have laws. So shit like this just doesn't proceed and go along. Like, we have to have a system to hold these people accountable. And the guy get it, you know, system's corrupt.
Courts.
Whatever.
How many judges you know that are corrupt? How many?
I've heard of at least 10.
There is. It's occasionally in the media, occasionally in the news, like, oh, this judge was found
some
to
really
be bribed.
Moral judges,
this
though.
Judge, you know, was involved in some kind of underground affair. Like,
every human being is susceptible to the power of money. I mean, even, you know, referencing the Super Bowl earlier, is like, even referees in the Super Bowl have been accused of being corrupted, you know what I mean? Or not even in the Super Bowl, but in football and basketball, you know. I think there was a scandal a couple years ago in the NBA where a couple of the refs were betting on games, and they got, I'm not sure if they got jail time or they just got fired or whatever. But
oh, yeah, I remember hearing that.
Yeah, they were betting on games. So if you're a referee and you're betting on games, you can influence the outcome by the calls you make.
By the call you make, yeah.
Hey, you give me enough money, no problem.
Dude, could we
you're going to give me more money. You're going to give me more money right now in this bribe than I'm going to make in the next 10 years of my life, you know, whatever. I'm taking that bribe, you know. That's human nature.
Or boxing, people taking falls for boxing.
Hell yeah.
It's human nature almost.
You know what? Let's take it to Trump. You're right.
But let's take it to Trump. So what Trump is doing right now, like, he's using his office of power. Like, he still has his businesses. He's still involved in these things. They're still under his control. He's still able to make decisions that will benefit international decisions that will benefit his companies. Local in-country decisions that will benefit his companies. The fact that he keeps talking about, and not only that, but his press secretary, Sarah Spicer, keeps talking about this resort he has. Where you go to Trump's resort, I forgot the name of it, but you go to Trump's resort, you'll have access to the president. They raised the price of this resort from $100,000 a year to $200,000 a year. Mm-hmm. So anybody who has the money to pay $200,000 a year potentially has an ear of the president, can run into the president of the country in that place and work out deals under the table.
All the lobbyists are going to be there.
Everybody's going to be there. So not only is that giving Trump money, it's also giving them access to make political decisions. So he's making money for selling his ability to make political decisions. How was he not already impeached for this shit? Like, this shit is not private. This is public. They talk about it. This Sean Spicer mentioned it. Like, it's not a...
Yeah, it's crazy, man. It's, the rabbit hole goes so friggin' deep, man. It's like, you know, but this is Donald Trump's nature. This is how he made his name. This is how he is Donald
Trump. That's how he made his money.
So we should hold him accountable.
We should, but...
Who is we, though?
We won't.
We the people?
We the people have...
I know, right?
We don't have the push. We don't have the financial, political push.
Vote. Vote for, like, your state legislators. Vote for local elections. Start moving up.
I think you're saying Donald Trump earlier was, like, out of touch. You know what I mean? A lot of the people that run in his circle, they're out of touch. They're out of touch with the lifestyle of people, babe.
Like, the lady DeVos, she hasn't ever been poor. Like, she hasn't ever been a normal person. Her family's been billionaires. Like... Mm-hmm. Forever, like, and yet she decides she knows how to run school systems when she has what she has no experience in, and neither her nor her children nor her parents nor anybody she knows has ever been in the public school.
That's why I said, yet
now she's the head of these departments.
So I said it's self-destructive because, like, why are you putting these people in charge of these positions? And it's not just Trump. I mean, these positions have been awarded to bankers or whatever other kind of people that have helped presidents get into power, but why would you not give it to a social engineer or a scientist? Or isn't that what's best for, like, not just America, but humanity?
Sure, you know what I mean? But if you look at the person who's benefiting from putting these people into play, why would they give up that?
Why would you?
Agreed.
Like, no, like, I get it. No, I'm all on your side. I'm all on your side. Humanity number one. Why not? Let's benefit mankind. I mean, 50 right? Years, because when you benefit humanity
in the long run, it benefits you. You know? When you have jobs in America, right, you have people have money to buy what you're making in China. You know what I mean?
Sure, I can make the future bigger, better, and brighter. In my lifetime, if I can make $50 more billion.
If you can make 50 more billion every 50 years, right, I mean, by investing in solar panel energy as opposed to the cost that it's going to take to maintain your water heater or... whatever else that it takes to maintain the heat in your home, if you can heat it with solar panels, and, you know, that way you won't have to spend cost on maintenance in the future, you could make a lot more money. I mean, it's kind of silly, man.
I just want to reiterate self-destructive. Here, like, on the Intelligent Idea Talkers, we don't have the answers.
We're just talkers.
Like, we don't have
answers. It's not intelligent idea answers.
This is not intelligent idea answers.
You want answers, you better go to Wikipedia. Go to
You better talk to Trump.
Go to that resort.
Wolf. Yeah.
What's his name? Don Wolf?
Yeah, Richard Wolf.
Richard Wolf.
Richard Wolf ain't got the answers either, man.
He ain't got the answers either, man.
He wants total social reform in the form of a socialist party. He likes labor unions. And like we said earlier, people are scared of change, man. And we're all susceptible to that.
What would the world be like if it was a socialist? Like, how would our country change?
In theory, people would share, you know, the mass of people would share more of the financial wealth and the,
like, economic
power of, you know, the political power of, I mean, it's evenly distributed. It's a socialist community.
A democratic socialist system, which was Bernie Sanders was going for, like, his whole idea. Like, I feel like that would be something, like, all we really want are our base needs taken care of, right? And the potential to advance. I think that's what people want. They want to have their health care taken care of. They want to be able to make enough money to buy food. And they want to have good families and, you know, just take care of their families. right? They want to be able to work and have their kids taken care of so they're not fucking running the streets, right? But if people had the ability for that, then I feel like our society, like our capitalism would increase because people would be able to put more energy into their work, be able to educate themselves more, you know? And I feel like in the end, that would be ultimately better for our capitalism in our country. But
it's not, like they said, it's not better for the immediate return. It's better for capitalism as a whole in the long run, but it's not better right now, you know? And, you know, but people are scared of change. And the kind of change that we theorize about on the podcast, because we definitely don't have damn answers for change. We got ideas.
Yeah, no answers.
You know? I mean, like Jay said, ain't that intelligent idea answers, you know? But, you know, it's scary. It's scary, right? What would a socialist party coming to power, what would that look like? What would that change, you know what I mean, in your day-to-day life? Like, you know, maybe people, I think on a whole sometimes, you know, this is definitely proven by the internet nowadays, but people as a whole, some people just lack compassion for one another, you know what I mean? Like, there's no compassion for the plight of people, there's, you know, as long as it ain't me or mine, I don't care, you know what I mean? Like, that's so sad, that's what he said, like, there's no post about Flint, Michigan anymore. Damn, that's fucked up in Flint, you know, 2 months later, it ain't on the news no more, I don't have to look at it every day. I don't live in Flint. All right, yeah. Damn, that's fucked up, I hope we get it fixed. Shit to do. You know, and it's like, you know, that's not to say that a lot of those people are non-compassionate, but, you know, when you see a video of somebody who's, you know, getting ran over by a car, and you read the comments, say, stupid bitch should have walked out the way, you know what I mean? But it's like that incompassionate nature that people just have.
Yo, I must say, man, YouTube comments are like the most vile.
I sent y'all a couple World Star joints. World Star comments, are they funny? Some of them are funny, but they're just, damn, but still, like,
World Star, like, you're not gonna run into a lot of, like, just hateful shit.
But the comments,
like, they're trying to be funny.
They're trying to be funny.
But YouTube is funny. YouTube is mean shit.
YouTube, yeah, that's
oof. And why the fuck you so mean? It was a video about, you know, damn, positive political change. You know, you have a video, you know. Yeah, it's crazy. So, but yeah, definitely wanted to bring up before the end of the cast that Morgan Freeman and Stacey Dash thing.
By the way, happy Black History Month. Yeah,
thank you.
Y'all.
Thank you.
You know what I'm saying?
Hey. Definitely be remiss if we didn't mention Black History Month. I think I mentioned the Super Bowl, but we didn't mention. Did we mention Black History Month at the beginning of the cast?
A little bit. We did. We, a little bit. Brought it up.
So
Black History Month, like, obviously, some people are for, some people are against it. You know, Stacey Dash has been very vocal, as Morgan Freeman has been very vocal about this. So, what's up?
Stacey Dash. See, this is why we need that camera, too, so we can transition to, you know, hey, well, let's watch the Morgan Freeman clip.
Yeah, right. That would be cool, 45 right?
45 seconds, you know.
And, so with Morgan Freeman, you know, he was being interviewed, and they were asking him, you know, what do you think about Black History Month? He was like, well, Black History Month is American History Month. You know, do they have a White History Month? You know, do they have a White Month?
And agreed with American History Month.
And the reporter was like, no. Well, I'm Jewish. So he was like, okay, well, do they have a Jewish month then? And he was like, no.
Right, you can't have a Black Jew? You can be a Jewish and Black. Jewish has nothing to do with skin color.
So, you know, Morgan Freeman was like, well, why don't you want a Jew month? And he was like, well, I don't want one. He goes, well, why do you think I want a Black History Month then? And I thought that was very interesting. And, you know, why don't they have more months then? Why don't they have, like, you know, Native American month? Why don't they have, like, Asian American month? Or maybe Muslim month?
Muslim American.
It's an interesting idea. They should. I mean, why wouldn't you?
My whole thing is, like,
yeah, think about something for Muslims when Ramadan comes around. I'm not Muslim, but it's a whole month where you fast, and, you know, it's a something that you recognize as this is what we do, you know.
And if I see a Muslim doing that month, like, I acknowledge that they're dealing with that, right? During that month. I would imagine that the whole idea of arguing for, like, if that's the case, I would say arguing for having a Asian American month or a Asian month or a Native American month or whatever these months, I would argue that arguing for these months will be a much better use of your energy and time than arguing why should we have a Black History Month? Like, why even bother doing that? We should just get rid of it. Like, no, don't get rid of it. Like, if you want to acknowledge more cultures or more countries or more people's history, then that's wonderful. Like, do it. Like, there's no reason not to do that.
Yeah, I feel funny saying we shouldn't have a Black History Month. That just, it makes me feel all...
We should have a Jew
history month. You know what I mean? But I do agree with...
History Month.
So we should add more of that.
I was about to say, I do agree more. With the premise that
so,
it is American
so
history.
Marginalized groups and minorities, you know, we should have a LGBT month, maybe?
Sure, why not?
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that's a little bit... I don't know. One thing that divides people almost as much as politics is religion. And a lot of people just are so caught
definitely
up in religion
don't
that
Christian
they don't... I think you'll always kind of have a divide between religious people and the LGBT community. And that goes beyond race, you know. Yeah. That's more of like a, you know, lifestyle, I guess, would you say? Or
LGBT?
LGBT versus anybody who's religious. I mean, you have religious, overly religious people in politics and schools and, you know, high offices in government. And not to say you don't have anybody from the LGBT community in those same positions, but, you know, you'll never, I don't think you'll ever get those two to kind of cope along, right? Because how can you convince a religious person that, you know, a lesbian is not living, you know, as they would say, sinfully, you know
but
what I mean?
The Pope recently said that he was okay with LGBT, though. He said, you know, I don't think he supports them, but I believe that he's friendly with them. He's like, you know what, that's cool, you guys do your thing. Like, I don't think he has, like... necessarily condemn them though, but he's still relatively new compared to like the other ones in the
past. Here's my thing though, I don't give a fuck if they like LGBT histories or LGBT people at all. I don't care if they like homosexuals at all. The only thing I care about, like, Christian doesn't have to like him at all. The only thing I care about is that you don't discriminate against them.
Mm-hmm.
You ain't gotta like them. Y'all ain't gotta be friends.
They're not gonna do anything to
that
you.
That don't fucking matter to me. Just don't touch them, don't hurt them. Let them buy their cake and shit. Like, let them do what they want to do. And as long as they do it to you against your will, then fine. Like, I don't care. Like, that's all I care about. So they can do whatever they want to do. And you worship whoever the heck you want to worship. That's
look,
fine. And however you want to do it.
You can
as
edit
long
this
as it
out
don't hurt
you,
nobody.
You can edit this out if you want. But do you think the audio from the Morgan Freeman... thing will pick up on the microphone.
Yeah,
sure. I mean, it was a pretty short clip, right? What was it, like 45 seconds or something like that?
Go to the Morgan Freeman one. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I think the audio might track a little bit on the mic.
All right, let's check.
Well, several high-profile celebs have called for a boycott led by Al Sharpton. Another famous actor actually agrees with Miss Dash.
Black History Month, you find ridiculous. Why? You're gonna relegate my history to a month? Oh, come on. What do you do with yours? Which month is White History Month?
No answer.
I'm Jewish. Okay, which month is Jewish History Month?
There isn't one.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
No. I don't either.
It'd have been funny if you just started.
I don't want a Black History Month. Black history is American history. How are we going to get rid of racism? Stop talking about it.
I don't agree with that.
I'm going to stop calling you a white man. And I'm going to ask you to stop calling me a Black man.
Are Stacey's and Morgan's views
I don't think
out of
that's
touch?
Possible.
So, you know what? Like, I can see where he's coming from everything. But when he said, you know, like, stop talking about it, that's very similar to saying, Tomi, right? She was saying, I don't see color.
Yeah.
You know, I think I said a statement like that on the podcast before. Man, I meant to take that back. Can we go back and do edits on like episode 8? You know what I mean? That I didn't see color. I think I said I didn't see color on the internet.
Look, we're growing and changing every day. It's all
see,
good.
No, exactly. See, we're evolving already. We're learning new things. The thing is, like, everyone sees color. It's how you react to that color that makes a person. You know
right.
what I'm saying? Like, you can't just ignore
and
Black
if you
people.
Say
how,
you
can
or,
get,
like,
how can you get past color unless you're blind, though? You know what I mean? Because race is really... You know, on the if you close your eyes, it's skin deep. You know what I mean?
Is,
everybody's
yeah.
a human being. You know, we have different cultural backgrounds, which kind of influence. But everybody, like you said, wants the same basic needs. You're a peasant in the Xiaoguang province in China, wants the same basic things in life as you do in America. I don't even know if that's a real province. I think I saw it somewhere. Xiaoguang. I don't know. But I mean, right? They want the same things, right? They want clean air, good water to drink, a way to take care of their family, yeah, you know, a exactly. job.
Everybody,
you know?
Yeah.
So the race is like really just, it's really ID. You know, like if I look at you, I see you're black. If I close my eyes, you're a man speaking to me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So how can you get past that, though? How can you get past what your eyes see? You know, that's why I think I said a statement like I didn't see race on the internet. Which I meant to take that back because you can see black people in the in some of the comments. Black people reacting about stuff.
You know,
black.
You know,
exactly. You like, man, dang, y'all should have just anybody who said dang. Yeah, you black. Come on now, you definitely have an urban background.
You know what I'm saying? But you know what? Like, well, Morgan Freeman's whole thing about black history being American history, like, it's not that he's wrong there, right?
No,
like,
he's,
black
he's history, totally, he's
and that's
correct.
Exactly. That's exactly one of the statements James Baldwin said.
He's correct.
He's correct. Black history is American history.
You can't
but
separate
But at the same
the
time, you have to acknowledge black history because American history, the white history has
dominated.
Historically dominated mm-hmm. the retelling of the story of history,
mm-hmm.
right? So in the point where if we didn't have black history, we wouldn't have any acknowledgement of black history at all. If we didn't mm-hmm. have this month or this time to stop and focus on it, it wouldn't be told. Like, it wouldn't be acknowledged as a thing, as a part of history that needed to be told. Like, we even now, we're still finding out new things that black Americans have did in the past. New things they've created. People have done great things in history.
Mm-hmm.
We're still finding out new things about this, right?
But if you look at history and, like, who writes it, most of the time it's not black people who are writing it.
That's true.
And that's why we're finding out new things now.
You think there would be black historians, right?
We talk about access to information a lot here on the cast. And, I mean, just with the access to information nowadays, like, you can find out more about black history in an hour-long documentary on YouTube than you could find out in a... then these kids are finding out in a year's worth of school. You know what I mean?
Back in our generation? Hell yeah.
Like, I mean, you know, you can find out about... Mansa Musa, he was like the richest man in history.
That was never even touched.
Exactly. Like, where's the African history, or what was the? It's a group of people that lived in Spain that were came from North Africa. Man, I forget the name of the people.
Spain
was like
from
North
Africa?
Man, I can't remember. I should do some more research before we start fucking recording. But goddamn. But yeah, it's just crazy. I mean, you can learn more about it just looking up stuff on your own almost. I mean, it's crazy why these things are not taught.
To a degree, you know? Like, it's you have to, right? Because only even with black history, they're not going to really reach past Martin Luther King and Frederick Douglass. Like, they're not digging. They'll talk to you about Nelson Mandela and call it a day, right? You might get those three guys. They're not going to talk about Malcolm X, though.
Like, barely talk about Nelson Mandela. I mean,
they're not covering James Baldwin.
What do most kids know about Nelson Mandela right now? How do you influence history?
Something about apartheid, and he was a good guy.
Man, that's I was looking it. At...
if you knew what apartheid was.
I was looking at something about, you know, we always harp on slavery, and America is, I think, eventually, you know, because we referenced gangs in New York earlier, and how you know, white people were racist against people that came from Ireland, you know what I mean? And,
yeah.
You know, they...
There's always been a...
You're Irish, you're Scottish, you know what I mean? And they were even separated, so discrimination...
Polish people.
Yeah. I mean...
That's true.
It's even discrimination on that level. I mean, how can...
And it wasn't until the 30s until they banded together.
I think Americans, we're going to evolve to the point where it has to be... You can't have any more racial lines, right? I mean, unless
the aliens come, we start discriminating against them.
Unless you come from Ireland. Can you really say you're Irish in America?
Not.
If you're an American Irishman, you know, speaking for white people, I mean... Are you sure you don't have a little bit of English up in there somewhere? You know what I mean? Maybe a little Spanish heritage? I guess the only way to find out is Ancestry.com, you know? Go back and get some DNA. How does that work anyway? Do you got to send DNA into Ancestry.com?
I think you spit in a vial or something. And then...
Only spit? Hey, only spit?
I don't know. That's
wink, wink, wink.
I see the commercials.
I'll send you whatever you want.
I'll send you a DNA sample. You want DNA? I got you. I'll bottle it right up for you. Like, what is this?
You still have a DNA?
Yeah, I don't know. I thought about doing Ancestry.com, though. That'd be
that's
cool.
Money, though. That's like 20.
I heard it is. I
thought about that, but
yeah.
I'm like, I want
to
do it.
Just to see, right? Wouldn't that be awesome? To be like, oh.
If it was free, maybe.
Yeah, right?
I heard my ancestors were from fucking Spain and shit.
Yeah. They'd be like,
but my last name is, I don't even understand none of that shit.
Yeah.
Like, what? What you talking about?
That's crazy, man. I agree with Morgan Freeman, though. It is American history.
It is American history.
You can't separate the two. Although, I feel more justified separating a month out for black people, specifically, than, you know, anything else. I agree. You shouldn't separate the two. Black history is American history. It's the same.
If they had a white history month, who would they put in that show? Because it would have to be, like, the most exceptional of white people, right? Like, but we already get, like...
That's what it'd be called. The most acceptable white people history.
The most exceptional of the whites.
You know, I always thought about this, though. Like, part of the marginalized group of people, right? The most oppressed, the most, like, you know, restricted and whatnot. If you look at the first Americans, the Native Americans and whatnot, I'm surprised they don't have a month.
They should have a month, right?
Like, I feel like if anyone deserves a month...
Jay. We can't admit the mass genocide.
Of course, of course. And I think
we can't say that we've been there.
We should learn about... what was that guy? You know what? I'm not going to say any Indian names. I might be wrong.
We spoke earlier about...
Let me not say that.
You said you saw Malcolm X laying there dead in the documentary. You saw I'm Not Your Negro. And... Like, so when you like look at some of the atrocities that were committed against Native American people as well as slaves,
they have footage and they have pictures from Wounded Knee, which is one of the bigger massacres they had on the Indian people. Those pictures they showed during that movie were like disgusting.
I mean, when you
like,
see the bodies laid out and
burned bodies of
children, even nowadays, when you see, that's why they don't show those images on CNN. You know what I mean? They don't show that shit. They don't show people bleeding from
a fucking
head
ditch
and
throw the bodies in.
They don't show a kid's leg sticking out from rubble. You know what I mean?
How do you justify that?
I saw something like they used
with
to
religion
back in slavery.
Religion.
They used to
religion will do it.
They used to take little slave babies to attract alligators. You know what I mean? Like they dangle the baby out, you know, and attract alligators and let them swim so they can catch make it easier to catch the alligator. You know what I mean?
But can we all
agree, though? Can you imagine that shit nowadays?
But can we agree, though, that humans in general are pretty violent and disgusting?
Oh, yeah.
If you look at the wars, like, all over.
I don't
like,
think that's black or white or Indian. No, that's
human nature. It's human nature.
That is human nature. Like, because we're animals, essentially.
Like,
even still, we find new shit to fight about. Animals don't.
But right, like if like you were walking down the street, this is crazy. But like if somebody split somebody's head open with a great axe, right? Like that's some medieval, dark ages shit. But you would look and be like, damn, that's his brains. What the fuck? You know what I mean? You take a little bit of an interest.
It's that
morbid
curiosity.
So yes, exactly.
Dude,
curiosity is human nature.
I definitely looked at. It was like. God.
They used to have a site called rotten.com.
Oh,
remember that, John? And they used to show like this dude who like. Head splatted open when he wasn't wearing a helmet on a motorcycle.
Yeah.
Like it was just his body with just a splatter of.
I mean, we got live leaks now.
It's crazy. Live leaks? See, now you're gonna make me go. I'm gonna spend the rest of my night looking at live leaks.
Don't go, guys. Look, I think our generation has seen some shit our parents have never seen or fathomed.
I saw a picture of
they weren't in the war. Like, we saw some shit that shouldn't be seen, but
this is totally crazy. And Juice, you can edit this out if you want, all right? But I saw some journal on rotten.com where like this deadlifter, right? Like an Olympic deadlifter was like lifting some
I already seen this
weight thing, right? And then like he pushed out his
intestines,
yeah. It's like it looked like it was his ass or something, like from the inside, because he was straining so much. Like it just, man, it was disgusting, man. Like it was
what?
Like
I've never
pushed
seen
his
that
shit out through his ass, man.
His
lower
intestines came out.
You can see some crazy shit on the internet.
His anal cavity.
He pushed him out. No, he was straining.
Wait, do you?
He was straining to lift this thing, man. I forget what the name
of
the thing you call.
Way more disgusting, but to me,
like it wasn't like
funny.
It wasn't like his whole guts, but it was like you know, what do they call it? Like your something.
Rectum?
Yeah, that's it. Like it's like your rectum. Like it was like sticking out of him. Man.
It was like
wait, he was
wearing
pants, right?
It was like prolapsed anus times 10 or something.
I was like, is that real?
Yeah, this is.
I gotta I don't want to see this shit.
That's
I
totally
gotta
disgusting.
See this shit now.
Yeah,
this you know what? This
I'm apologize. Sorry. I apologize.
Why? Why did you? Now I gotta find it.
Now it's like that morbid curiosity.
Now,
it's like, what?
No, exactly.
Ew. You know what I mean?
Oh, this is gonna suck.
Yeah, that's crazy, man. That's crazy.
You going to that joke? Like, oh, this is gonna be terrible.
Well, Morgan Freeman definitely has some ideas I agree with. Stacey Dash just sounded like a fool on that. Stacey Dash.
Well, her question, her thing was, we have to decide: do you want segregation or not?
But that's not that simple,
bitch.
It's not that simple.
Black history is not about
if
segregation.
If you don't want us to be racist, don't talk about Black History Month. And just, shut up.
That's not the case. And that's completely mischaracterizing why these things exist, right? Why Black History exists. Like, why Like, why did people fight for segregation or desegregation in the first place? It's because black people were getting equal treatment, right? It's not about who was getting what. It's about whether or not we were getting the same. Whether or not we had the ability to advance like everybody else did. The ability to learn like everybody else did. That's why. It's not about our history. Like, that's... No, no. That's completely mischaracterizing what you're trying to say. Mm-hmm. Or what why exists.
Stacey Dash. Stupid. Stacey Dash was hot in that that Kanye West video. What was it? Yeah, you know
that.
The...
I hate that that's her.
Was it called Come Around or Things Come Down or something like that? I forget. Yeah, When It All Falls Down. All Falls Down, that's the name of it. Yeah. She was tight in that video, man. Oh my God. I think that was like my first exposure to Stacey Dash.
I've seen it before.
Wow. Back in the day, Clueless, man.
Yeah, she was in there, but she didn't really show out. Like, that dress she was wearing in that video was just ridiculous, man. It's like, wow. But, yeah, man.
You swing around the camera?
What's the time, man?
Man, we about, hey, you hitting that mark, man. Like, 156.
Damn it, Jay. Look, we had a conversation. Look, I'm blaming this on Jay. Right? We had a conversation about, what was it, like, one of the first couple casts. We were like, man, are we going too long? It was like an hour, 15 minutes or something like that, you know? Like, yeah, I mean, damn, is this too long? Do people really want to listen to an hour, 15 minutes?
I feel like we probably should just do one... If we just have one topic, because we branch off so much, I think one is more than another.
The last one three topic, casts, we gave it an hour.
The last three casts with Jay, these jokes have been 2 hours long. Like, it was like, go back and look at the time. I think the first one Jay was on was like an hour 47.
Yeah.
Last one was like an hour 52. This was what? 156?
I think we should just start cutting.
It's good content.
It is. I don't want to cut it.
It's a great conversation. I think we should just stick with one. And then we're going to go off into tangents anyways. Mm. We might as well just stick with one theme, perhaps. One theme,
yeah, okay.
I wish, you know, I hope that some of these movies start coming out and we get to review those. Because I want to bring, like, sometimes a little more lighter side to the cast, yeah, man. We've been talking, sometimes we're a little
look, morbid. We're sorry, guys. We've been talking a lot of politics, a lot of
but this is, we live in the D.C. metropolitan area. This is political central. You know what I mean? Yeah, this is what tough. We see on the news.
The hub.
Right.
It's what's around hub, us every day. So this is what we talk about, you know?
Trump's president, and it's day. I don't know what day it is. Man.
Who knows, man? You're not.
It's like it's like day 257, and yo, it feels like we've been here for years. But
crazy. Hey, anytime Trump wants to come on the cast, I'm welcome. You're welcome, Donald.
Yeah, come on, Donnie.
You know,
Donnie Tiny.
You want to fly me out to your resort? I'll be there.
What if he wants to buy you then?
I'll be there with bells and whistles on. Or if he wants to buy me, Donald Trump can buy me. I'm for sale. You know what I mean?
Hey, what, just, you want to buy a show?
No, he wants to buy me.
I ain't trying to have him pee on me.
Hey, look. Oh, see, come on now. You ain't got to take it there.
Wait, what?
It's like Dave Chappelle said, like, if you're not old enough to decide if you want to get peed on or not,
exactly.
Just move. You know what I mean? Exactly. Like, yeah, it's like, I'm not
going to start spraying on the first row.
Exactly.
Right? You're old enough to know.
I'm not just going to stand there and let you pee on me, Donald. Like, you got to aim, bro. I'm like, you can't just, you know.
Or at least pay for
chase
it.
Chase. Yeah, you got to chase me and aim, bro. Like, I'm going to be running. You probably got some stanky.
I don't
want
to get down this conversation, but that's a lot of money.
Hey, what Dave Chappelle said? Hey.
I mean, like, I'm talking about uppercuts.
What Dave Chappelle say? Just keep it away from my eyes. Donald, if you got to do it, okay, interesting question. Last question to go out on. Would you let Donald Trump pee on you for $10 million? Yeah.
$10 million?
How much?
$10 million. I'm sorry. Look, stay away from my eyes. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. Wear goggles.
I'm sorry.
I wear goggles. Let's do this.
Oh, maybe that'd be the full, is it a front gear, son?
I mean, like, you have full to like you have gear, to like get there on a knee, right? He might give you some knee pads or something to get down on, you know, and you have to let him pee on you. That like, can I close my eyes? I don't even want to look. I'm like, just go. Go.
$10 million, though?
$10 million, bro. Like, hey, a shot. Hey, look.
$10 million is a lot of money, but.
That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money to have no self-respect.
Like, can I take a shower before I leave?
How much is your self-respect?
Do I have to get in the car with piss on me?
Might be worth $10 million.
No, you got $10 million pee, dog. I might take it. I might take that pee, dog.
Yo, if you go to that resort. If you go to that resort and then never come back. And you have your own little resort afterwards. We're like, oh, okay, we know what happened.
You'd be at a party. How'd you get your money? Man.
Let me tell you.
Human nature, man. We all want the basic things in life, but when you can afford things like suicide doors in your car and freaking just all these decadent things, you know, I mean, it's human nature to lust after those things, right? So sure, we Donald, want the finer things. I would let you pee on me, Donald. $10 million. I could go home. $10 million in the bank account. You check your account. You have $10 million in cha-ching. We hop in the shower real quick.
I have to pee on people for the rest of my life to make myself feel better about it. Though.
Give me a steak omelet. Right, but could you like Jay said earlier, we can't fathom having that much money, right? So if you get $10 million, what's the first thing you gonna think about doing? Man, I'm gonna pay my cable bill for like the next 3 months, dog. Like, right? It's like the basic thing.
Right,
like,
I'll pay every bill. I'm not having
grocery. I'm gonna go grocery shopping like crazy. I'm gonna go buy a deep freezer. Just fill that.
None of that store brand stuff. You're going name brand. Exactly.
Nah, straight up organic.
I'm buying a cow and they chop it up.
You're going organic, yo. Yeah.
Yeah, like we can't fathom having that. Like, but when you have that much money, you don't think about things like that. Donald Trump don't think about paying his car note. He just buys a car, right? And it gets delivered.
Yeah,
he don't drive.
Does he know what a car note is?
He don't drive.
They fly him to Walmart.
Do they have the same...
He don't go to Walmart.
Does Donald Trump wake up one day and say, man, I got to go grocery shopping today? That thought doesn't enter his head.
He don't know what that means.
Yeah, you're right. I bet he's never said put it in the grocery store.
Does Donald Trump say, man, let me stop and get
some
gas? Unless
he was buying a grocery store.
Right.
I don't think he ever...
Like, his grocery shopping is buying stores. What is a grocery?
He doesn't have the same basic thoughts as regular
people. Yeah, that's... I never even thought about that.
That's deep, right?
Like, does he say, man, I got to go get some gas, man. I'm about to be on E, you know? Does Donald Trump know how to pump gas into a car?
I bet he does, but I bet he he doesn't have to do it.
I bet he doesn't.
I bet he's never touched a steering wheel.
Ooh,
does he have a hot rod that he just drives? But no, why? Because he has somebody else driving. But like, I would imagine I would have like a fancy car. I would just like
even
a push,
buying
right?
clothes and stuff. I bet a tailor comes to him.
Yeah, you're right.
It's kind of hard to imagine because you know, man,
he only wears Trump brand. He only wears his own brand. He don't wear Nikes.
It's hard to imagine because a man, you put your pants on the same way I do, but right? Like, but
no, you don't.
They sew them around his ass.
People to put
stitch his pants around his legs.
Does Donald Trump put on lotion when he gets out of the shower?
No.
Like, I mean, it's a basic thing, right? I'm serious, right? Like, does he lotion himself? Because, like, it's like those same basic things that you do, you know?
He has Mexican maids lotion him for
him. Yeah, it's like, what?
If you would do
we
it,
we can't
too.
Imagine
if he
being
paid
there.
You would do it.
And then he pees on
him. We saying, man, we would let him pee on me for $10 million. What is $10 million to Donald Trump? It's nothing. I invest that on the afternoon. I put that into a golf resort. You know what I mean?
I don't know.
And this is our president of the United States, people. He's so, yes, he dominates conversation.
He might be broke.
Neil deGrasse Tyson actually once. I know we're stretching this out, but Neil deGrasse Tyson actually talked about.
Don't worry, you just can make edits and end up cutting three whole minutes out of the cast.
Neil deGrasse Tyson actually talked about.
You edit it for 2 days and be like 3 minutes, guys.
Yeah, pretty Neil much. Yeah.
Neil deGrasse Tyson talked about how rich Bill Gates was, and he was like, "I want you guys to kind of fathom his rich, but condense it to our level, to our understanding." So he was like, "You know what? If you guys were walking down the street,
made me sad,
right?
Sad.
If you guys were walking down the street, right, and you see a penny on the floor, you ain't picking that up, right?
You'll look at it. You'll think about picking it up. Yeah. You'll be like, nah, it ain't a quarter.
You look at a nickel, though. Okay, that's not bad. Okay, a dime.
I might still not pick up that nickel. It depends.
You're right.
I'll pick up that.
Takes back power.
I might not. You're right. Okay. A dime, though, that's not bad. I'll pick it up a dime.
Dime and a quarter, yeah.
Quarter? No, of course. I'm snatching.
I'm gonna snatch
that shit, yo. Okay. So if we condense that to how much we're willing to bend over and pick up, right? Bill Gates, the equivalent of picking up like a quarter for him is something around $34,000. That's what.
Like,
we have
to bend over. Like,
that's what Neil deGrasse Tyson said. So. And for Bill Gates, because he's worth so much money, if he actually took the time to bend over and pick up a $100 bill, he actually lost money already.
So look, it's like, so you get in the car and you see something blow. Damn, that's $34,000 over there. Let me go get that shit. You know what I mean? I'm like, I'll do that shit for a quarter. If I see a quarter, I'm taking that.
So for Bill Gates, his equivalent, if he sees like, say, $10,000, he's like, I don't need it. That's how rich he is. Just fathom that for a second. Just think about
that. What do you do with that money? Like, what can you do?
When we talk about millions, we talk about billions, we talk about all these things, right? We're getting peed on by 10 mil right now, okay? I can't even imagine walking past.
And I would still take that
That's
pee.
That's crazy.
It is. We get peed on by 10 million. I can't even imagine walking by $10,000 on the floor and be like, you know what? I don't need that.
Do you know what $10,000 could do right now, man?
I'm just saying, think about it from their perspective. To walk by and be like, 10,000, I don't need that.
We can't imagine it, man. It's like, it really is, man. It's like, how do you accrue and are worth that amount of money? You'll never be able to spend that in 2-3 of your lifetimes. You know what I mean? Like, you really don't need... What's the difference between 80 and 40? What's the difference between 10 and 5 billion?
I would need, like, intergalactic purchasing power to be able to spend that kind of money. Like, I mean, like, what the fuck would you buy on Earth? Like, I could buy dolphins and whales and sharks.
With $10 billion. With $1 billion, right, he spent, like, $1 million every year.
How many PlayStation 4s is that? Billions of PlayStation 4s. It's like, what the fuck?
Like, right now, we go make a $500 purchase. Solidable purchase. $500. That's nothing to sneeze at. You know what I mean? $500, you can't imagine that they think about that. You know what I mean? Like, somebody who's at that Warren Buffett level or something. They don't think about that.
That's breakfast.
Some of their, like, lunches and dinners, easily that much money. We're talking about caviar. Talking about foie gras. Talking about, like, you know, high-class wine.
Some eating shit out.
Wow.
So, I mean, that's just putting things into perspective. It's crazy.
Yeah, I'm hungry now. You ever tried caviar? Either of you guys? I never tried that shit.
I tried it.
Why would I want to eat fish eggs? It's crunchy. Can I fry this fish, put some hot sauce on it?
Yeah. You know what? I think it's getting to the point where it's like, it's so rich because it costs so much. It's like, you know what? I want to try it.
Can they scramble caviar? Because I just can't imagine like opening a can. Yeah, I mean, you know.
It's like, no. I
can't imagine opening a can and just spooning out some caviar.
I assume it's probably like, like super nice sushi almost. Because sushi occasionally has some fish eggs on it, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I assume it may be something like that.
Is caviar like jelly? Can I spread it on a biscuit?
Yeah, it's like spreadable. Like, I haven't had like high-end caviar, I guess, whatever the fuck that is.
Mm-hmm.
But
I went to a wedding once. I had some low class. I was like, it's all right.
Weird crunchy
caviar. So if I tip the can back, will it just like flow into my mouth? Like, is it like that kind of looseness, like viscosity? Like, or is it like I have to spoon it out and spread it? Is it like jelly? Is it jam or jelly?
I think it's kind of
why
like
we're talking about caviar.
Because it's rich, yeah. Because it's rich.
Rich shit, son.
But yeah, Gucci. I mean like
caviar.
I don't know. Maybe that's high class taste.
But none of us would turn down that kind of lifestyle if we had the opportunity to have it though.
No. I don't have that kind of resolve.
Yeah, I mean, just the power of money and what it can do for you. Just
I would try to flip it and try to use it for greater good, but turning it down.
But once you have that kind of money, though, you don't even need to. You don't need to do anything else with it. You're
no, you do. Then you have a moral. Then you still have to have a moral compass. And if once you lose your moral compass, then you're fucking.
That's
shit.
Because you grew up where you grew up. If you were born into that. Would you still have that?
Well, I'm glad I grew up the way I grew up.
When you've never had to go to the grocery store, why do you think about going to the grocery store? You know what I mean?
Sounds like, what the fuck is a grocery store?
So, yeah, it's like he doesn't think about, you know, the mom at the grocery store looking at her cart and seeing what she can put back because she's not going to have enough money to pay for it. You don't think about that.
Listen to our show like, what the fuck is a grocery store?
Yeah. You can be acting as an advisor.
What's this grocery store? What's this
grocery store business?
Buy me one.
I want to try one. I want to try one. Buy me one.
Yeah, give me a grocery store.
Donald Trump buys giant. Yeah,
Trump mark.
Trump mark.
Oh man.
Trump line.
Well, yeah, I guess that it's gonna do us up. Episode 15 in the bag. In the bag.
1-5.
Guys, damn. It's crazy. Well, is that gonna take us out, fellas? Any last thoughts? Welcome to America.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Happy Black History.
Hey, any immigrant that manages to make it in through this executive order or over or underneath the wall that's proposed to be built, welcome to America. You know what I mean? Because you're going to step into the same shit.
Come on our podcast.
You can come in here if you want. You know,
hit us up.
I meant to say this earlier, not to extend, but like even if he builds the wall and all that crap, like imagine like the people that have come to this country due to the economic struggles of their country, like, what kind of conditions must be there for you to want to come here? You know what I mean? Because, like, think about how bad things would have to be for us to say to ourselves, man, I'm going to go move to Canada.
So here's the thing, right?
Sucks here. Well, it's hard for us to fathom that, you know?
Definitely.
There like, are people who live at a lower status, you know, economic level in life than we do right now. And we're not rich. You know what I mean? We're not wealthy. Yeah. Sucks, man. It's going to build a wall. What about planes, bitch?
What about tunnels, motherfucker?
Yeah, you know what I mean? How you gonna stop that shit?
Like, you gonna dig a tunnel. How deep would the wall have to go? They can still dig a tunnel deeper than that.
What about boats, too?
So I said, like, they can dig a tunnel deep and then break through the walls.
Like, how tall is it going to be? How thick? I mean, is it going to be like the wall, like in Game of Thrones? I think Donald Trump watches Game of Thrones, why this whole thing got proposed, you know what I mean? Wants to build the wall.
He would.
And then put the Night's Watch along the wall.
The Night's Watch?
Yeah.
Watch that beat the Trump's watch.
Yeah, yeah. So, I guess that's going to wrap us up. Once again, I'm your host, D.
This is Juice.
Jay.
Yeah, out. Till next time.
Thanks for checking us out.